We're obviously in the middle of quite possibly the longest hurricane season that I can remember. And one of the things, the thing that gets damaged the most, that's your roof.
Yeah.
And if you have any damage or if you just need a new roof, you owe it to yourself to check out our friends at Secured Roofing and Restoration.
Yep, it's SecuredRoofingAndRestoration.com. If you have any problem with your roof, give them a call. They'll come out and inspect it and make sure that
touchless,
it's okay.
Super duper safe.
Oh, yeah. And if there is a problem, they can work directly with your insurance company to make sure it gets handled. Also, they have financing available.
Super easy.
If you need a new roof and you can't afford it now, you can make payments. All the crew that puts on your roof works for Secured Roofing.
Yeah, that's important.
And they can get shingle roofs done in one day.
Yeah, that's absolutely what they shoot for. They still offer emergency tarping services 24-48 hours after you give them a call. It's really quick.
Yep. And if you use Secured Roofing and Restoration, we will send you a prize, a huge merch prize, just like we did our buddy Will, a BDM Will.
Yeah.
He got a brand new roof, had a great experience with Secured Roofing, and we sent him a prize. So if you get a new roof, just let them know you're a BDM or you're a Tom and Dan listener, and we'll get you that merch prize. It's SecuredRoofingAndRestoration.com. Welcome to A Corporate Time with Tom and Dan. I'm Tom.
Hey there, I'm Dan.
So we are on location at Hollabox, and I'm super excited because this is the first time I've seen the renovation in person.
I've seen it too.
Doesn't even look like a renovation. It looks like a brand new compound.
Yeah.
A big German beer compound.
The woodworking and the wood.
I could streamline that for you. The money spent. Uh-huh. Oh, my God, money spent.
I just, Travis was saying it earlier as walking through, I like...
Big butts and you cannot
lie. And after he said he likes big butts, he said he likes a nice, snappy wooden bar.
I do like a wooden bar, wood everywhere.
Yeah.
For whatever, I don't know, it just feels more cozy.
Wood everywhere.
It just feels like you should be drinking.
It feels like an old school pub.
Yeah. So the more wood, the better. That's what my pop-up said.
Oh, my God.
So...
I'm so sorry, guys.
Chef Pat is here with us.
What's up, guys?
And now, this area we're standing in, obviously part of the renovation, but this is the indoor beer garden area. But is it called something different?
We do call this the indoor beer garden, or the indoor part of the beer garden. Downstairs, we refer to as the lodge. That's why it's got all the animal heads and all the lighter wood down there, you would see in a hunting lodge. Upstairs, of course, we have the beer inside, but then we've got the deck outside, the actual beer garden part.
Gotcha.
It's a beautiful deck. It's
all completely open. I mean, God, how many seats are out there? It's huge.
I think there's around 80 seats out there now. We're trying to keep it socially distanced.
Sure. Yeah, of course. So I know we're going to drink some beers. We're going to eat some cake. I kind of wanted to do a little
bit of... Whose idea was that? When did this bit just be... did this bit just become, let's come party with the Hollabox? It legitimately...
I heard cake and beer, and that's
like I'm like, well, what are we doing? I'm like, I think we're going to eat some cake and drink some beer.
That's all I know.
Sign me up.
And full transparency, this is after our ghost tour, so I'm worked up quite a thirst. And I'm starving. blood sugar crashed.
Well, you have to work out later, so this will be great.
So, all right, maybe we'll start with some beer because I'm thirsty and
Tom's going to pass out.
And I want a delicious beer.
Can I speak on something
for... Should we sit down? Are you okay?
We're going to have to speak on this for a second.
What?
You are having difficulty speaking in your mask.
Well,
you're going to have to start practicing at your house.
Yeah.
You're going to have to start wearing it inside and talking to your sons like this because you're too weak. No. I feel like your mask muscles haven't been flexed. You're the only one sweating. Nobody else here is dripping
too hot.
I have the same mask. I have the same mask on you have. You just screamed you're too hot and rubbed your belly in front of our clients.
I'm sorry. I'm not used to talking this much and then having my face covered.
He's bringing you something ice cold.
All right.
And if you want to sit down while you drink it, I think you can. Now, it's the rule we can take our mask off if we're seated.
Yeah.
I'm going to do it up like I'm really at Hollabox.
Oh, my God. Sweet relief. Oh, it's like God. I got out of jail.
Oh, it is really nice.
I want to put my hands up like
breathe in the air.
Andy Dufresne.
What am I drinking here?
You guys are drinking the Hollowbox Kolsch. So this is made for us by Three Daughters out in St. Pete after the Kolsch Dyer Beals, where my dad is from.
Oh, my God. It's so refreshing. Oh, my God. It's like this is going to be
the best beer I've ever had.
I'm not joking, because doing the Halloween special, we were wearing that mask talking the entire time.
I haven't even heard our Halloween special. This is the best one we've ever done. That ice cold beer coming off of wearing that mask. You know what? I'm going to tell people, put your mask on about an hour before you get.
Walk around San Francisco.
I'm serious.
Yeah.
I'm going to sell it even better. It's already amazing when you come here. Now, but walk around for about an hour with your mask on. It's got
to
be hot.
Yeah, and bring your most annoying friend to talk to you.
Yeah.
Until you get the full commented experience.
Bring a friend of yours that's really annoying, and preferably another friend who dresses like a baby and wears like little kids' clothing and Ghostbusters garbage.
That doesn't stop talking, and let the guy that does the ghost tour talk. And walk around, get super annoyed, hot, and then drink a beer.
And then when you come in, order your beer, then go to your responsibly, you know, social distance seating, sit down, remove your mask, take a sip.
Oh my God, he just chugged the whole thing.
He chugged his whole beer.
Oh, God.
Everything tastes better when you work for it.
Okay? I've never seen you do this.
I've never seen you drink a beer that fast. You should have put that in the BDSM
for a split second. I thought he was going to take his pants off or something. I've never seen the best beer like this, guys. I'm sorry.
Oh my God, I feel amazing
every time we meet at Hollowbox, or we talk to these guys, we ramp up how we're going to embarrass them.
Something about German food just makes you want to chug a beer.
Yeah.
The color just came back to his face.
How am I more sweaty than Butler? He's got a full Ghostbusters long sleeve. Yeah. And he's wearing a shirt
underneath.
Yeah. And he's not even sweaty. I am the most sweaty I've ever been.
Now, beer, when I'm coming here and if I want to get a beer, do you guys do growlers, crowlers, or do I just get my beer here and just take it home? Is that how I can do that?
Gemütlichkeit. You're supposed to enjoy it here.
Yeah, I prefer that.
Yeah. 100%.
But I just didn't know, because sometimes, you like to take a little, you just don't drink it in the car.
So we do have the market where we sell six packs, cases, mini kegs, all that stuff over there. I'm not sure the rules. It still might be a gray area with
growlers. Well, it's county to county. That's why it gets all weird.
Yeah. So I'm honestly not 100% sure.
It's a stupid question for me to even ask, because you never know.
But I mean, slide in here with a growler, I'm going to make sure you get taken care of.
This is delicious, though. And this is a Kolsch style beer.
That's a Kolsch style beer. It's a light lager. I think Christina said it's from Three Daughters.
Oh, yeah.
It's a really, really good hot weather beer.
You gave us that. See,
right,
I
sent it
to
six pack before.
This is okay.
You got to look at the label, yeah.
I apologize. One sip of beer and I'm drunk. This is what I was asking. Can I purchase this beer? Yes, this is the beer that 100%. You guys had already gifted us. I fell on about four of these on a Saturday while updating our computers and doing stuff.
Yeah.
Now, normally I go to our studio to fix major problems that we have at the studio.
Yeah.
And I'm coming clean at Hollowbox because I feel like I should. We have never had any computer problems. I just go to the studio to drink and hide from my family.
Yeah. I knew that, Dad.
Okay.
That's why I don't ask you. You're like,
I
got to
go check on the restaurant, baby. I'll be back in an hour.
Yeah. Oh, you do it too. Okay, great. Yeah. So, all right. I'll meet you at the studio and I'll meet you at the restaurant.
Chef Pat, let's talk cake. So
this guy's lost his mind.
He's wasted right now.
He is.
Good timing as well. Here comes cake.
What is happening, dude?
So the let's talk German cake specifically.
I gotta get my phone out.
So is there a particular dessert
that cake's taller than I am
that is specific to Germany, like something that German
like a German chocolate cake?
Absolutely not German chocolate.
No, we made that, right?
That's a Pennsylvania thing, I think. Like Pennsylvania Dutch.
That's like the gordita.
I'm going to put it in front of Tom right now, but this is the Black Forest cake, the Schwarzwälder Kirschkuchen, the Black Forest cherry tort.
I've had this.
It's got black cherries soaked in Kirschwasser.
Oh, you're going to dig this, dude.
And then the cake is rubbed with kirsch. And we make the whipped cream in-house, and chocolate cake, and cherries, and chocolate.
So this is specific. I'm drunk.
This is specific.
Tom's cut off.
This is. Let me tell you something crazy about this. No sugar, no fat.
No, really?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
And you can eat as much as you want.
That's the crazy thing about German food and German beer. Very low calorie.
Dude, are you crazy? Look at that. That's authentic.
Yeah. So I'm going to have... Now, is there, I found a plum in the bottom.
No, that's a cherry.
It's a cherry.
Tom pulled out a plum.
Butler just helped himself to your cake,
He's so drunk, he goes, I found a plum in my cake.
All right, so this is...
Oh, my God, man.
The okay, I'm going to have a cherry with the cake.
Just say Black Forest cake, right? That's an easy way for dum-dums to say it. Okay.
Hold on, I can't get the plum.
Get the plum.
Oh, my God.
He's so yum. That it's so yum. Yum good. With the plum. Oh, that God, I've dropped a knife on my foot. I'm bleeding everywhere.
I feel like Germany has their desserts on point. Out of all the countries, you know, there's other European countries that do well with desserts. But
I like French desserts are nice, but a little too buttery, I think.
They're big on the pastries, but Germany's stuff is very rich and flavorful, but not overly sweet.
It's actually kind of light. It's not really a heavy cake.
Yeah.
That's the thing with a lot of German cakes. The whipped cream, it's just sugar and cream and whipped together, so it's not this heavy buttercream. It's very light, and you get the flavor of the cherries or the plums in your cake.
Yeah. You're right, because
that's good.
There's some desserts that is, like, so fudgy, they're thick, that you have one bite of it, you're like, oh, my God, that one bite was 900 calories. It's too rich and fudgy.
Bring in the 900-calorie fudge.
Oh my!
Just talking about how the British people have the most terrible desserts, so it's important.
Well, get him, get Butler good.
Dave brings us more cakes.
Now look at this one. This one is like like an almond.
The one here now is my favorite. It's called Bienenstich. It's a bee sting cake. And it's a white cake.
Oh, my wife's chest has that cake.
Now you're embarrassing me.
Well, I'm drunk too. I just took a little longer.
It's white cake with a Bavarian cream in the middle and then a honey cinnamon almond glaze on top.
Dude.
I like it in the morning with tea or coffee or in the middle of the afternoon with tea or coffee.
Or right now.
Or right now.
With a beer. I'm going to get an edge of this.
Every morning I wake up, I have a football-sized butter cake with my coffee. And then, sensible 18 sausages for lunch.
That is an extremely simple, super delicious, yummy, traditional tasting, like something your grandma made.
Butler just dropped cake.
Dropped cake onto my old guys.
These are new floors, guys. These are new floors.
Why isn't there some sort of science that can, like, fix the... Why can't we eat anything we want and be cool with it? Doesn't make any sense.
We can. You're just going to only be cool for, like, a couple of years.
Yeah, but it's...
Or for a couple of bites.
That's amazing.
It's really good.
And I just want to keep eating, but...
Can't some scientist invent a pill that I take that, like, blocks, like, all the fat and calories from absorbing into my body so I can enjoy the experience of eating whatever I want.
What is the cream in the middle of that?
That's a Bavarian cream.
Oh.
So good.
God, it's delicious.
And why English Dave is here, too, all of these cakes are made by his wife, Nikki, who's our pastry chef, and she got trained by both Chef Pat and my mom and her own recipes, and she's been with us a very long time.
How come you're not, like, super obese? No, you don't look like you're married to a cake woman.
Yeah.
That is delicious.
Yeah.
Now, what is this thing?
So that's a seasonal dessert. That is a pumpkin croissant bread pudding. So we bake our croissants in-house. And then the next day when they're stale, we soak them in a pumpkin custard and make bread pudding with them.
Bread pudding is British, right? Because I feel like you do it in your accent. You're like, you want some bread pudding?
You got a real British person here.
Well, he doesn't know anything about it. I always ask him about
Brexit.
He doesn't know anything.
Like, he's literally made in England.
Oh, okay. Yeah. He knows.
English Dave. Yeah.
English Dave knows. Bread pudding.
English Dave sounds like every motocycle guy I've ever met.
Yeah.
I keep trying to tell them.
Oh, my God.
Also,
they just keep getting better.
Hold on.
Warm, dude.
I don't even like pumpkin, and that is delicious.
So good.
Because that doesn't taste like pumpkin.
No,
that tastes like awesome.
Yeah.
You get the spice, you get a little bit of the richness, you get the cinnamon.
That's breakfast.
And then it's got a salted caramel sauce.
My plums. Stop chopping the plums.
You dropped the plums.
That is
one of the best things I've ever eaten.
Yeah, that tastes like breakfast.
My God. Like, you could literally just have dinner, have cake and beer, and then
what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
Cafe and Kuchen.
It's a traditional thing. It's like afternoon tea in England. In Germany, at 4 o'clock, you go get a cup of coffee and a piece of cake and chill out for an hour.
Wow. I'm gooking.
And I'm coughing.
Cafe.
Cafe? Yeah, yeah, I thought it was coughing and cooking.
Coughing and cooking in the morning.
How long does it because you guys cook these and make these in-house.
Every day.
Every single day.
How many cakes do you have to make a day?
I'm sure you have industrial ovens and stuff, but you stick 15 cakes in there? How many cakes?
So chocolate cakes we bake, twelve at a time, then they have to cool so you can, ice them so the whipped cream and stuff doesn't melt.
Gotcha.
But I have bakers here at 4 a.m. every morning to start the bread, the cakes, the bread puddings, making the strudel every day. 4 o'clock every morning we have bakers here.
Gotcha, yeah. I mean, to hand make every ingredient in a cake and then bake it.
Well, you gotta only be 23 because you need to stop at 4 o'clock to get your coffee and your cake.
Yeah. What country has the worst dessert? I feel like. Flan? Flan stinks.
I like flan.
You like flan? Not as good as this cake.
It's not as good as this.
Yeah.
Wait, we missed one.
Yeah, what is that?
You missed two, actually. This may be the most quintessential German dessert. It is Apfelstrudel. It is made in-house every day. It's got apples, golden raisins, cinnamon, just a little bit of sugar, and then a vanilla sauce underneath. So it's technically a creme anglaise. It's like melted vanilla ice cream, really.
Chef Pat, do you feel like the strudel is the one food that people have the most misrepresentation about because they get breakfast I feel like
toaster strudels.
And then it's just frozen garbage. And then people are like, I've had a strudel and I don't like it. It's like, it's fine. It's like a Pop Tart. And you're like, no, a real made strudel will blow your teeth out.
People confuse strudel and streusel.
Right.
Like a crumb cake, the crumbly topping with the cinnamon streusel and the sugar. That actually is streusel.
Streusel.
You know German, Dan. Streuselkuchen is, you can have apple streusel, which is apple coffee cake pretty much with the crumblies on top. Or you get apple strudel, which is a thin pastry rolled up with the apples inside.
So, Are you going to sing the strudel song?
Christine and I have a strudel song to make strudel.
Yeah, I want
to
hear the strudel song.
I know that one. Strudel, I made a lot of clay.
If I'm a rich man,
they're dancing like a Russian. Why are you dancing a Russian? It's weird.
So it's for the dough, and this is how I make strudel. Every time if I have to make strudel, I still have to sing the song. It's how we remember the recipe.
We can't remember recipes, so we have to sing songs.
What are the people that make songs that you remember stuff, Dan? I know you're a musical person.
Oh, you mean composers?
Like anagrams almost, but it's with a song to remember the
jingles
recipe. Yeah, whatever.
Okay.
Are you ready, though?
The one with the United
States. Four cups of flour, four large eggs, a pinch of salt and vinegar malt. Knead it in the mixer, watch it spin around, add a half a cup of water to make your mama proud.
No.
Oh, the mama proud line in there.
I got scared
when
you were doing
that. Well, especially because it is actually my mom.
I was like, what's happening?
They pointed at Tom and he freaked out.
Don't point at me.
Hey there, Tom. It's your birthday.
You're like, oh, this isn't happening again. What's happened once when I was talking at Applebee's?
Hey, Mr. Scott, what you gonna do?
What you gonna do? Make a dreams come true.
I was like, what did I promise these people?
You thought for a second you promised.
Yeah. Everybody. I think I promised them some sort of
Tom, you promised the entire staff at Hollowbox that you'd buy all of their kids brand-new cars from Sports Subaru and Mitsubishi.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I thought back then I could make it
and
happen.
You're supposed to have Mike Stacks come in and make the presentation today.
He still doesn't work there anymore. I'm joking. Mike Stacks still works there. He still works there.
Wouldn't surprise me.
Oh, Trump, take the mic from him.
You're drunk. Why am I doing up here? I sweat so much.
Why
during the whole
week.
My plum hit the table. Now it's tainted.
Don't say your plums are on the table.
Oh, I got another beer too. Yeah.
They We're just show up.
Home.
Dunk the strudel.
I'm gonna go sleep at Scary Gary's ghost house.
In your beer.
Oh, what is that?
Oh my god.
This is important because you've had all of the traditional German desserts, and the first thing you mentioned was German chocolate cake. And that's what this is. We caved and we make it here because everybody asked for it, but it's not German. So now that you try this against all these, I'd love to hear your thoughts.
This is your version of German.
It's
going
to be hard
cake.
To beat this cinnamon almond creamy thing. That's going to be hard to beat that. And this guy right here, warm croissant pumpkin.
Yeah.
goodness, whatever
banana
that
bread.
Is, sauteed some
Not
sort
banana
of
bread. Sorry, bread so, pudding.
Chef yeah, Pat, that's amazing.
So, what is, the German chocolate cake is just an American thing that. Americans started saying it's not a real...
Yeah, I'm not even sure how that came to be because
right,
everybody coconut. Knows coconuts are so German.
Right, it's so weird.
Yeah, I 100%. Like I said, it originated up north in a bakery. I don't know why. I think maybe the baker's name was German or something like that.
That makes
so they
sense.
Call it a German chocolate cake. But other than that, there's nothing German about
it's
it.
It's really good, but...
But you see how much wow. sweeter it is than
it
all
is
the other desserts.
So it is a lot sweeter. Mm. I'm telling you, what takes a crown, though... That almond thing.
My favorite.
I'm the bee sting.
The almond.
So if
well,
you
this one's seasonal, so I don't want to hook my wagon to it.
A
because
hybrid.
I'll come down here and then they'll say,
at Magnolia
oh, I'm
Square
sorry,
Market,
little guy, it's gone.
At the market, we do bee sting croissants. So we take our day olds, stuff them with Bavarian cream, and then put the same filling on top. So you can take that, dip it, and eat it.
Oh, my God.
Oh, that sounds really good.
This I'm not joking.
I feel like we're living like kings right now.
No.
Nobody has ever done anything like this for us before.
We would do this every day.
My wife has never done something this nice for me.
We won't even charge you for advertising.
You know what? I will pay you. How much do we owe you, probably?
I will pay you for this. Can I take the beer? I've never had this much cake in a long time.
I've never seen you eat sweets.
Yeah, I usually.
But I'm glad he has good taste, though. He only chooses to eat his sweets where he knows they're made.
But that's the thing. Like, if you only eat the best sweets,
then you don't want the crap sweets.
Yeah, why yes. waste your time on eating like what
I
you're eating?
Eat dessert out anywhere.
Well, why wouldn't you? This yeah. I've been telling people this is not a restaurant. This is an experience. When you come here, book some time. Mm-hmm. Don't book a... It ain't a 30 minutes pop in, pop out. Book some time so you can really come and enjoy it.
It's an authentic European experience. Yep. Yeah, we cook everything from scratch in our kitchen. Like, you come in, sit down, order a schnitzel. Your schnitzel gets breaded, and your schnitzel gets fried. They're not pre-breaded. They're not pre-fried. Nothing's done ahead of time like that. We do everything a la minute. We cook it to order.
Yeah, yeah. And it shows because the food's so good. Now, I'm going to put you on the spot a little bit. Out of all these cakes, Chef Pat, which one do you like the most? Because
that's
I can't
question.
Even really make a decision because every one that I ate was like, oh, well, that one's good.
Let's be honest. You can't lose on any of them. You know, even the one that wouldn't be classified.
So
I'm not
a chocolate
one that
guy.
Would not be classified.
What is wrong with you?
At a traditional German dessert, baby.
Yeah, that's disgusting. So I'm not a chocolate guy, so I'm really not big on the Black Forest or the German chocolate. I'm more of any of the other three.
Okay.
But as a standard, I like the bee sting cake because it's so big I can always take a half of it home and give it to my wife or eat it myself.
Sure. Yeah.
And I think Tom liked the Kolsch the best.
Yeah. I mean, listen, all of them and the beer, obviously my favorite. But
yeah, we're beer guys.
Guys, thanks so much for the cakes and the beer.
Could people do this? Could we? I think we should.
Well, you can come and order all the cakes you want and all the beer.
I almost want it.
Especially for Thanksgiving. What a great time.
Right. Oh, yeah. Right. Okay, well, let me ask you that. If someone wants to just order a whole cake.
Well, that's what I want to do.
For their Thanksgiving or whatever party they're doing, they can do that, right?
Sure. Go to hollerbox.com. We have a section on there where you can order cakes and order desserts and order stuff to pick up for your holiday parties.
I will be doing that.
We do a lot. I hate to say specialized, but we do a lot of special diet needs. We do gluten-free stuff. Our market stocks regularly 3 or 4 different gluten-free muffins, gluten-free cookies.
That's awesome.
We have gluten-free beer.
That's very cool.
It's a thing now, so we try to
accommodate
everybody that we can.
I had a freak out when I was walking over here. I haven't been into your market yet. And when I walked in there, I was looking for you guys. And I used to go to a little German deli when I was a little kid to get sandwiches with my mom and my dad.
Mm.
It was in Daytona Beach. And then we come home. And it smells exactly the same. Mm. And I started freaking out a little bit. Yeah, it started like freaking my brain out.
Aroma memory.
Yeah, there's some sort of a sandwichy type
smoked
thing in there that...
Yeah, smoked meats and sauerkrauts.
Yeah, there's something in there that I'm going to have to just get and try to find what is the thing that... It might be a mustard of some sort. Something is triggering my brain.
Well, imagine if you're having a small Thanksgiving this year and you're German.
We're not doing turkey this year. Maisie put her foot down. My kid.
Oh, really?
Yeah, she read this poem and highlights those little silly kids magazines.
Yeah, so make those.
Yeah, and there's a poem in there about doing something, making your own traditions or something. She's a real,
innovator.
Yeah, a real innovator like her mom. So I don't get my turkey dinner this year. No. We're going to do something different. So
come see me, Dan.
Maybe I'll just come here.
But imagine
if you, for Thanksgiving, went and bought a traditional German cake, and imagine how...
I'm going to.
If you had, like, a German meme or something, like, look what I got, like, oh, yeah. Like an actual German... Right.
And then
cake
you
made.
Don't have to make it yourself.
Oh, oh. Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, if you try to do any of this yourself,
it's never going to come out as good.
No,
but
hell
also,
no.
You save time.
Yeah, yeah. This is.
You can pretend and we won't tell.
Yeah. Right. You can lie and say that you made it.
Guys, thank you so much.
Yeah, we really appreciate it. You're too sweet to us.
This,
thank you, guys.
This is literally my favorite show in town.
Yeah,
I come here, can I start getting drunk, eat some cake? I'm like, what have I done?
This is a great job.
This can't last. This cannot. This will not last for sure.
Well, one thing that will last is Hollabox. So come see these guys, and we'll take a break. And
bye-bye.
Welcome back to A Corporate Time with Tom and Dan. I'm Tom.
I am Dan. Samantha, our producer, is here. Butler's in the other room. The fish are alive. Sean cleaned the tank. It looks amazing. New computer's been installed. What are we doing now?
So is Samantha magic, or is it because most celebrity relationships will end up in a breakup? And
how dare you?
No, I think she's magic.
Well, yeah, if it's magic, I'm not trying to use my magic for bad.
Are we magicing now?
Because
now I don't want to do it because I don't want to break this couple up.
I don't even know what you're talking about. I'm excited about this.
Well, man, I got an update.
All right, let's do some moves.
Here we go.
She's giving you all the news. Celebrity couples, who's gonna lose? Are they gonna stay together for the end of time? Or are they gonna break up after adopting 20 kids? You don't know. It's just a matter of time. Take it, Tom.
Brought to you by Porky's Barbecue, right there in downtown Apopka. Go outside. Nice outside. Nice day to eat the some pork? Barbecue, yeah. On Porky's patio.
Mm-hmm.
Porky's patio.
Sit outside and have some pulled pork sandwich.
Welcome to Porky's patio. My name is Peter.
Banana pudding, all good.
Sometimes they have live music out on the patio.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Live music on the Porky's patio with Peter.
Daniel Dennis and the Venison.
No, Dennis and the Venison. Oh, you mother. Make me so damn
could
mad.
Be there.
You know, I mean, you want a hot take?
Mm-hmm.
Is it Hot Take Tuesday?
It is.
All right, I'll give you a hot take. Any DJ that DJs a biker event, not a real DJ.
Come on. They're a biker DJ. That's
no
a category
such thing.
Of DJ.
No play such on thing.
That's yeah, they're just hitting play because they've got, what is it? Rock and roll hoochie coo on their iPad.
Well, what's that?
They're
rock and roll hoochie. Rock and roll hoochie coo. You never heard that?
I don't think I know that song, but
actually,
I want to.
Yeah, you've heard rock and roll hoochie coo.
That goes along with Who's Porkin'.
I will I'll make this statement. They are more of a DJ, biker DJs nowadays, than any other DJ nowadays. See what I'm saying?
No, I don't understand what you're saying.
Like a regular radio station DJ, they don't even pick the music.
Right.
It just comes.
We're talking about live event DJ.
A biker
not
event
radio
DJ
station DJ
is just a guy playing rock and roll hoochie coo on his iPad. Here's a. You've never heard this, Sam?
I don't know yet.
You never heard a little.
Who is this?
Rick Derringer.
It's not about the music. It's about the sweet, sweet on-the-mic improv that they're able to do.
What's up? It's DJ Dennis in the Venison here at Parkins Barbecue. Let me get a hell yeah. You cool cats and kittens that rode all your Harleys up here. Let me just remind you, the Mick Ultra's 2-for-1s right now on the Parkins patio with Peter and DJ Dennis in the Venison all night long.
That's what they do. And it's stupid. And they're all stupid.
Yeah, oh, please.
I'm going to end up doing that when I'm old. You know that, right? Like,
yeah. Please.
That's why I'm allowed to call it stupid, is because eventually I will end up doing that. Probably a Porky's Patio. Because I know Steve. This can't go
He'll
on.
Definitely hire
this
him.
Won't go on forever. Steve's a wonderful man. He makes delicious top-tier barbecue.
Mm. Yeah, yeah.
Actually, it doesn't sound that bad. You know what? I flipped. I came full circle on
yeah. Back at
now
it.
I want to be a biker DJ. Yeah.
I also,
why not?
Yeah, why
That's
not?
It's fun.
My favorite
I don't have
thing,
a motorcycle anymore.
You did my favorite thing, which is when the biker DJ tells everybody to scream hell yeah, but they can't read the fact that they're in like a, there's like 2 dozen people just slowly eating barbecue in front of them. You're not at Coachella with a, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's not like, marshmallow in front of 100,000 Europeans in a field.
It's literally like 15 maybe, people
well,
eating
know,
barbecue.
Porky's bike night will get kind of big. You'll be 75 people out there, 100 people out there. Right, you know.
No, but I'm not talking about Porky's barbecue specifically. Right. I'm talking about just any, I've been to a lot of biker events.
Yeah. Man, I set up audio for a band to play at the Leesburg Bike Fest.
Oh. I'm familiar.
That was one of my projects I had to do.
Oh,
and
yeah.
That was an interesting
time.
Was
that your internship and being sexually harassed all day? Chef's kiss.
Yeah, that was
what
part
a lovely
of it.
Internship.
The update on who's porking, you did mention there. There seems to be a pattern here. You know, people keep clowning me in the BDM group. Every time I talk about a couple or people porking, somehow it deteriorates. An update literally from just last week. Brad Pitt has broken up with that girlfriend that has the husband on the, you know, well, I guess he's the side piece. But so he called it quits.
They've started calling this unporking. You've been unporking people.
I've been unporking. So with that said,
do you think he broke it up because people found out and then he was like,
I don't think so. I think
he,
like I said last week, he knew what it was. It was a casual hookup when they're in town together. I think maybe he was just like, you're back there with your husband. I'm over here. It's fine.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, and I'm sure if she comes into town, they'll probably meet up, you know. Mm-hmm. But they're not claiming each other. But this week, I don't know if you guys watched SNL.
A little bit.
But weekend update anchor Colin Jost was sporting a wedding ring.
Mm-hmm.
So him and Scarlett Johansson did a small wedding over the weekend.
Well, this wasn't this because they skipped it on Halloween night, right?
No,
they had one live on Halloween.
With John Mulaney and the Strokes.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Why did I think they skipped it?
Did they all dress up?
I didn't watch it. I'll be honest with you. I haven't had a chance to watch it yet.
The Strokes look like some fun, stinky guys.
They're a good band.
Yeah, I like the Strokes. My wife hates the Strokes, but I've always liked them a lot.
The John Mulaney one was not Halloween, the weekend before Halloween, right?
No.
Yeah, I think so, because I watched the John Mulaney one.
I don't watch Saturday Night Live.
I believe it was the week before Halloween. They take Halloween off because I think they figured no one,
I can't
the audience,
take
won't watch
you
it.
Saying Halloween.
Nope, John Mulaney was definitely this
Halloween
past weekend. Yeah.
Am I losing my mind?
Yes, you are.
Well, I've been losing my mind. I told you, I've been losing my mind. You can't lose yours.
We'll both
we
be
need
crazy.
One.
So,
Jost.
So yeah, he just casually, you know, wore his wedding ring on the weekend update, and Michael Che had some jokes about it. He says, "You just married Scarlett Johansson, and I just bought an electric bike. We're both doing equally great."
So I know that they didn't talk about like them dating, and they made some jokes. And when she hosted Saturday Night Live, like
a few years ago when she hosted. They met that way.
But then they did it again when they were together, and now they're married.
That's really interesting that she met him that way. And apparently this happens a lot. You know, you come on set, you have some sort of chemistry with the person. That's exactly what happened to Jesse James and Sandra Bullock.
So
she comes on set for her nephew, whatever.
A lot of people,
Monster
meet
Garage.
While they're working.
Yeah, they meet.
Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie.
Yeah, they met.
They revealed it Thursday that they'd wed through a post on the Instagram account for Meals on Wheels America, and the post shows a picture of the Staten Island ferry with the words "Jost married."
All right. I hate that a lot more than anything.
Now, is she going to be Scarlett Jost?
I don't know. I don't know if she's going to change the last name. She's been married before, and she hasn't changed her last name.
She should be Scarlett Jost.
She has a good name.
Scarlett Jost.
Yeah, she's
is
already,
that a real
that's
name?
Her brand.
I think so.
She won't change it because she's already made her career, and that's her.
Also, I'd like to throw my hat in the ring.
Scarlett Johansson Jost.
Yeah, she could be. I'm just going to throw my hat in the ring that if my wife was Scarlett Johansson, and she said to me, I'm not taking your name. It would not rattle me one bit because she's goddamn Scarlett Johansson.
Yeah, of course.
I just want to throw that out there.
If it did rattle you,
and if it does rattle you, you're a crazy person.
So the
just let her do what she does.
Okay, this is what I find fascinating. So imagine Colin Jost. He starts, let's say, before Saturday Night Live. When did he start? Like,
maybe 5 years ago, four or five
Colin
years ago.
Colin Jost?
Yeah, yeah.
I think he started in 2005
Seems
as a
like
writer.
He's been there a long time,
so,
I feel like.
But you're an unknown writer of Saturday Night Live. And,
writer in 2005, became head writer and Weekend Update co-anchor eventually. Yeah.
And when did you do that?
I'd have to look that up, the specifics on that.
What's his favorite ice cream flavor?
This is what I'm fascinated by. So you're this writer. Now, being a writer of Saturday Night Live is a big deal, but if you're behind the scenes, a lot of times no one will know who you are, right? So you just another Harvard nerd that you know,
like Mulaney. A lot of people didn't know he wrote for SNL for years.
So you're just like
a beast,
super smart, funny nerd, and you know. And Scarlett Johansson, you watch in movies, is this A-list movie star. You know, one
but
of
she's
the
a nerd, right?
Hottest women in Hollywood. Yeah, but I'm saying before you meet this person, like she's a movie star. And then you meet her, this movie star, and then you end up marrying her is crazy because I'm sure he sat there just like the rest of America and fantasized about being with Scarlett Johansson and then thinking to himself, this is an impossibility.
Right.
It could never because that's what you do, right? You fantasize
he's
about.
He's a good looking guy, though, man.
Yeah, he is.
And he's funny. You know, like, what more does he really need?
Well,
and he's the exact opposite of what she deals with day in and day out.
But that's the thing. Like, he's probably thinking, well, Scarlett Johansson and the Scarlett Johansson types, the A-list movie stars, don't date guys like me. They date other A-list movie stars or whatever it is. You know, it's like,
right.
I'm sure.
I don't know. She, like, married some weird nerd director before or something, right?
Yeah.
Who was her husband before? Like,
you know
she
what?
Doesn't typically date, like the Brad Pitts and, you know.
I always got a good vibe about her ever since I think there was paparazzi photos of her smoking weed out of an apple. And when I saw that, I'm like, all right, she's fine. You know, like, whenever I see somebody...
I've always liked Scarlett Johansson.
Whenever I see somebody... Like, if any celebrity is, like, they're people like the weird or recluse or whatever, if I see them on a beach smoking weed out of a Coke can, they're okay with me.
Because
I'm like, you're normal. That's what a normal person would do. You're like a regular old, you know, you could go to Target with me and be just fine, eat some popcorn.
Yeah, a little trashy.
Yeah, well, like a little normal, you know?
Right.
Like it's like, oh, if you could have a, you know, smoking weed out of a Coke can, have a draft beer.
Well, most actors and actresses, I could imagine, grew up probably, like, not rich, you know what I'm saying? Like, the only exception I can think of is, like, Julia Louis-Dreyfus.
Angelina Jolie, you know, I mean, she kind of grew up...
Yeah, the daughter of a...
In a Hollywood family.
Yeah. But I feel like that may be the rarity, and the most actors and actresses, like, the old quintessential, you move to L.A. from wherever you live, from your small town, and you become famous. It's like, so you grew up humbly, and therefore... You smoke weed out of an apple when you can. And then the other, like, I guess, smaller percentage that grew up, like, ultra rich or already a celebrity, it's probably harder for them, even though they have the, like, the people they know, the people and stuff like that. It's just like, what's the chances that a celebrity or rich person's son or daughter is going to be famous one day?
But
it's so rare to begin with.
But are we way off considering the fact that in that writer's room and what those people have to deal with day in and day out? I mean, you kind of hit the nail on the head a couple of minutes ago when you were talking about just Harvard nerds. That's a whole different animal than what most people would ever be around. You know what I mean? Like, that is like the upper echelon. That is a select and very, like, regimented club of people that, you know, and I'm sure there's secrets and, you know, like, and rules and, you know, like, it's a kind of a what do you even call that? There's like a traditional aspect of doing that.
I like Colin Jost, at least of what I see on SNL.
Yeah,
like,
he comes off like really good.
I don't know the person or whatever. Seems like a funny, nice guy. Takes himself not seriously. Like if you watch him in the that Mark Twain Awards with Dave Chappelle.
Yeah, it's good.
Like he comes out, he's making fun of himself. Like, why am
I
here?
He's a little bit of a bus decker.
Yes, yeah,
like,
yeah.
Like, nice,
yeah.
Nerd, yeah. Has a good sense of humor.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I'm sure, like, and not bad to look at. Good-looking gentleman.
I would let him babysit my daughter.
Yeah. So, he has everything, like, the comedy aspect.
Yep.
Good-looking, like, not...
funny.
Doesn't look like a pretentious a-hole. No, you know what I'm saying? No. Like,
doesn't take himself too seriously.
So...
I think this one's going to
so
work out.
So, how's he going to blow it? Or
no. I think this
because,
one's going to work out.
Inevitably, when we report on this, something happens.
Well, if something does happen, my guess would be that it would lean more towards her being a weirdo, not him.
Mm-hmm.
And the only reason I say that is because she has ascended to a level of popularity that I think could quite possibly make you a weirdo.
Yes.
Well, and he is not.
Hard to be a normal person when you're that famous.
Right.
Although he is pretty famous too, but not to that level. Like, I think
she's bringing a kid into this marriage because remember she has a baby from a previous marriage. So now he's going to have to be stepdaddy Jost.
It's But think about the pressure of you're just a celebrity couple that, like, how hard that is to stay together in a world where now, obviously, paparazzi is following you around everywhere. People are reporting on every single possible fight you could be on, or speculating fights, or putting out all the stuff.
You think it's better now because of COVID and masks?
Yeah.
For them, for celebrities. But, like, anytime.
Also, there's, like, laws in place now that aren't. Things aren't as bad with paparazzi as they used to be in, like, the early 2000s. There were, like, no rules back then.
Like when people are getting
like
run off the road and murdered.
And Britney's hitting the paparazzi car with an umbrella because they won't leave her alone.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, I'm deep in the...
No, I know.
So, now, I wonder if they do, like, okay, so she's, what is she, what's her net worth and his net worth?
Let's check this out.
What do you think it is?
I'd say she's worth 75 mil.
Okay,
that's gotta be a lot, right?
That's a good number, although...
I could be wrong. I think that's high.
She probably doesn't do too many, like, indoor... That's where you make big money. You do, like, some sort of product endorsement. She does big makeup line stuff, right?
I couldn't tell you.
I don't know. Doesn't she, like, the face of, like...
I'm sure she has been the face of, like, Revlon or Maybelline.
That's where you make money. I'm going...
CoverGirl.
A little bit less. I'm going 60 million.
Okay. You guys are way off. 165 million.
Whoa!
Yeah,
okay.
That's good.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
she
good.
Is one of the most popular and highest paid actresses in the world.
One of the Joes
and has been for over a decade.
Wow.
It's 100 million off. Not too bad. And then Colin Jost.
That's walking around money.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Colin, what do you think about old Colin?
He's worth
stand-up
five.
Comedian and head writer for SNL. What do you think?
Five mil.
He's never...
SNL doesn't pay a lot.
No. And he's never been in any sort of big-budget movies.
No.
Maybe small-time stuff. I'm even... You said 5 million?
Yeah.
Four?
That's
pretty damn close.
One to five?
I'm going... I'm just going to go a little higher than 6 million.
Right on the money, 6 million.
Yeah, you saw it in the chat room.
I can't see nothing. Are you joking?
Did they say
look
it?
How small it is now. It's extra small.
Oh, that's true. There's no way he could see that.
I literally just see lines. I couldn't even tell you one letter. Anyway, so the, so that's a big discrepancy.
Yeah.
For sure you've signed prenups and stuff.
I don't know.
Possibly.
People do stupid things because those prenups are insulting sometimes to people.
Yeah, but you have a team and lawyers, and you have people that you like. For instance,
it's almost like they're demanding you to do something because it's for your best interest.
You're a business at that point. So let's say if we weren't married when we started this company and we built something, just like Scarlett Johansson built her brand and the company. She has
been married twice before. She was married to Ryan Reynolds. From 2008 to 2011, and the French businessman, that's the guy I was thinking of, who, like, nobody really knew who he was. It's not like he was, like, a famous celebrity.
That's the one I remember.
She had a kid with him, and she was with him from 2014 to 2017.
Okay.
So it's, like, irresponsible not to sign a prenup, because all the people that are employees of your business, you can't just, if you marry someone, now they're half the owner of this business.
You just changed the whole game.
And let's say you get divorced years later, and this person wants, you have to sell half of the business or at least buy them out, and, you know, it becomes super complicated. So
that's
I think
mess.
Just because of all the money and everything and the business part of it, you probably have to sign something saying, like, hey, all our stuff is separate. But yeah, that's a good. And how much older is she than him?
10 years.
It's because he's what, early?
Seven
he's
years.
35.
Yeah,
what's she like? 40? She might.
I don't think
42,
she's
probably.
Old.
Yeah, she's
I'm 44. Yeah. I think she's over 40.
They're the same age.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
She's 35?
She's 35. He's 38.
Oh, he's older?
No. Yeah. She looks older than him, yeah. I think.
Why did I think no she offense. Was older?
He's got that baby face.
Yeah, he
yeah,
does.
Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah.
He does.
That's she
does,
weird.
Like, I'm not saying she doesn't look good.
No,
that's,
she looks
I'm not
great.
Judging. I'm just saying she does look older.
Do you think it was because of, like, roles she did where she, like, remember that monster?
Oh, the Eileen Voorhees.
Yeah, I mean, she made herself.
I kind of like, thought that was hot, though. I like
wait,
a,
what?
I like a good
that was
tank
Charlize
toppy.
Theron. Oh,
oh, oh yeah, okay. That was Charlize no, Theron. I like a good Walmart tank top.
That's right. I get them confused. I like, right
a, I like a old catfish face.
Do you know who we're talking
woman.
About? Do you know who Scarlett Johansson
nah,
is?
Yes, I do. But
yeah, Black Widow.
Look, we're born showing our age because Charlize star. Theron was our age.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Scarlett Johansson.
You're right.
He
you're
just
right.
doesn't want to admit it because he likes to leave himself in the younger category. But if you listen to his references, I swear
yeah,
to God,
yeah,
he's
you're
like,
right.
I haven't seen this since the last time I was playing trombone with Glenn Miller. I'm like, what the hell are you talking about?
Yeah, I am stuck in a time.
You're way younger than me, and some of your references, I'm like, what the hell are you talking about?
I stopped paying attention to, I hate all of, like, everything that's out there, so I don't even look at
I
it.
I hate everything.
I'm like, all pop culture stuff, I'm like, oh, garbage. And then now, but I gotta be careful because then become an old man.
No, you have no choice, but you'll have to know
Scarlett
some of
Johansson
it.
Is Charlize
Who's
Theron.
Hotter? In their, I mean, at their,
in their prime.
At their prime.
I gotta go ScarJo.
ScarJo.
Yeah. She's got a better body.
Charlize
yeah.
Theron?
Yeah, yeah. I think
I've never Johansson seen ScarJo's body.
Yeah, I think she's done.
Has she been what? Nude?
Yeah.
Because
yeah,
I know Charlize Theron's been nude.
Yeah, 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 yeah. She's been.
She's got more, you know, she's a little thicker in areas.
Yeah, I want to see.
She got big
honkers.
Nice ass. Is that what it is?
She got big. Nice ass. How would it be?
Were you singing? No. Was that your Post Malone?
She's got a nice ass. That's what it be. Tom Malone.
So did they have a big wedding? Probably not, right?
No, no they did a very small
a giant
intimate wedding.
Super spreader wedding. They're coughing on each other.
Well, you got enough money, you could probably, you know, space everybody out.
I was riding bikes with Maisie last night. We rode around the lake.
Yeah.
And because I was, you know, just anything to just get this kid's got so much energy. It's just anything to wind her down. And we're riding, and we ride down by the dock over here in Lake Baldwin, and they're on the dock, and you guys have all seen it, and there were, like, at least 200 people all together, like,
oh,
packed,
man.
like hugging each other, and I'm like, what the hell is
on
happening?
On the dock?
And
fine.
I'm like, run! And we're, like, we're on our bikes. I'm like, go! Go like the wind!
Now, like, do they constantly clown him on SNL about being married?
Probably. Because she's worth $165 million.
But I don't think so, because I think that...
They made the jokes when they were dating.
Right.
You know, they throw it in there, especially in the Weekend Update.
I don't know if you do. I think you can only do that for a certain period of time, and then I think you got to back off, right? Because that's his wife.
Well, also, make fun of me all you want. I'm married to Scarlett Johansson.
Yeah,
I don't care.
Yeah, but I mean, like, at the same time, it's like, at some point, it's not funny. Or, you know, like, okay, whatever, Scarlett Johansson joke.
Yeah.
Because Pete probably got clowned.
Oh, for sure.
But they made it into bits every single week. There was him and the joke
about
it. He
put it in his stand-up special.
And I think other people have, like, who... Yeah, we could do, like, a bracket. We could do, like, a bracket graph and see comedian with, like... hot movie star and or model and who
okay it's funny
put that in your porking list.
It's only funny one way. It's funny if a guy marries up and marries a super successful rich movie star, and then the opposite, it's not funny for whatever, like if a cast member married Brad Pitt or something, like it's just not as clown worthy, it seems like.
Are you
right?
saying that because traditionally men
are the breadwinners?
Easier to clown on a man, seemingly to you. It'd be easier for you to clown on me for marrying up.
The joke isn't as funny the other way in our society.
Like, you wouldn't tease Andrea for marrying up. She had to go down to go up, if you know what I mean. Little guys.
Gotta get up to get down.
But yep. that,
gotta get up.
But you know down, what I'm saying? It's down. Like you're busting your buddy's balls for marrying the movie star as opposed to...
You married out of your league or whatever, yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Like, she's way richer than you. Yeah. Like, it's the yeah, this is what we do to Butler.
Yeah.
You
know, it's
our jokes. You clown them, yeah. You know? But we're all jealous of it because who doesn't want to be married
right.
to the... Scarlett Johansson, 160 right. million. You know,
but I will say,
yeah, bust his balls.
Odds would probably lean towards this being a porkin that's going to break up.
Yeah.
I mean, if we were running this in Vegas, and I'm not saying that to be disrespectful. I'm very happy for them, and God bless them. They don't know me, and it doesn't matter what I say. But I'm just saying, the odds would say if this was in Vegas and there's a line.
Yeah. You take the mean, and it's 50% already.
Right.
So then it's like, all right, you have 50%. Now, which edge is it going to? Yeah. All the pressure of being so famous has got to push the edge to higher than lower, right? It doesn't help being in the public eye every single second.
No.
So it's like this puts more stress and more pressure. And then also...
And it's hard to spend time together and start to visit each other and vacation with each other and spend time. And then there's a kid.
She's out.
Oh, man.
She's filming movies. He's doing SNL. Like, so lack of time spent together. Then you mix in, like, you know, the pressure of the paparazzi and then everybody knowing your business at all times.
They're both fairly private, though.
Yeah, but still, any sort of tidbit anybody can garner from anything, like, they'll just take a picture of you walking.
They're digging through your trash.
Like, if he walks, to get coffee with another person from SNL and she's a woman, they'll be like, look,
is he cheating on ScarJo?
Of course.
So I know they probably ignore all that because, like, she's seasoned in this. She's been famous for a long time. So she, I would assume, is healthy about it and doesn't look at it.
Mm-hmm.
But still, it put some sort of pressure.
Sure.
Then think about this. Like, imagine being in a relationship where you're both so famous and so rich and there's so much business tied up into it that actually being together and being apart or breaking up means something to your brand and business. So then there's extra pressure. Like imagine where now your business and people around you can be affected just by your relationship. So I'm like saying, too much pressure, they're going
to
break up.
Yeah, I don't want them to.
Minus 180.
Yeah, I don't want to.
Oh, I shouldn't have done this one. I want them to succeed.
I do too. But I'm just going to be real with you. I'm gonna say I don't
feel. You think she has another baby with old Jost? They'll make a pretty baby.
That'd be a smooth baby, too.
Yeah.
That baby got good skin.
Well, that's what they'll do to try to save it, right, before they break up.
Oh, man. Is that a bleak outlook?
And they name it something weird, right?
Yeah.
Joey Jost.
Joey Jost sounds like he could get down on start a boy band with Joey Jost.
Yeah. That's, you'll have the baby to save the relationship.
Yeah, but it still drifts apart.
And they'll be fine, obviously. But think about it this way. Can you see them growing old and dying together? Like, how rare is that?
I don't even see myself doing that with Andrea and May.
Who's even done that as a Hollywood famous couple? Like,
I don't know.
Did Sean Connery's wife, did she live long enough to see him
die? Who knows what she went through?
Punchy
John Voight and the snake from Anaconda? I think they're still together.
Yeah. Is Goldie Hawn and Kurt Russell still together?
I thought
together?
They broke up.
Did they?
Yeah. That was a big story because they were together for 27 years or something, a long ass time. And
I still, I'm just
according to Wikipedia, they're still together.
I still have a DVD copy of Bird on a Wire. That is a damn fine film.
Romancing the Stone.
Oh, dude. That's Kurt Douglas, though.
Oh, yeah.
That's old, eh? I like it so much my tongue can't get out.
Oh, yeah.
Man, you gotta be flicking it hard to get cancer on it, right?
What's happening?
Yeah, what are you doing?
It's too much.
Don't teach me how to do that. I don't want to know how to do that.
It's the outside. What's happening?
What are you doing?
Don't
never go past the second ring.
There's cancer back there.
You drill too far, you get to the center of the earth, there's lava down there. You gotta stay up top where the topsoil's at.
Yeah.
It's fresh up there. Stay where the fresh stuff is.
Good for them. It seemed like good couple.
Let's hope for the best.
All right, good porking. I like that.
So what, okay, Colin Jost, what is his career path? Like, he goes to becoming an actor now? Because...
I think he's really trying to get into, screenwriting more.
Writer?
Besides just the Weekend Update stuff and the SNL writing.
He could... I mean, he could pull off acting, right? I feel like he's good enough for some...
Never seen him act.
Some classes, some stuff. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, he's around.
He's a good-looking guy.
His wife's a good actress. Yeah. I think
naturally, just by being around that much acting, I think he's 10 times better than anybody I know who's a pro actor.
If John,
just because he's in it, right?
If John Cena can do it, you can do it, Jones.
I've
seen John Cena in movie big. Come on, Cena.
WWE is acting still. You, like, there's character development.
Colin Jost, like, even presenting on Weekend Report, and like there's an acting component to all that.
Sure.
You know, is he ever in any sketches at all?
I don't think I've ever seen him in a sketch.
I don't know. Yeah. I think he's all behind the scenes.
Yeah.
All right. But I think he could do it. I still believe in him.
But I
still think the marriage is going to fail.
Mm. Yeah, fail. Definitely fail.
So I think we figure this one out.
Yeah.
Okay, so how long of a timeline do we give this?
Ooh, this one is...
I'm going to say less than a year, guys.
Ooh, wow. That close?
Yeah.
I think it'll last longer.
I think this is a product of the pandemic.
But they've been dating for... They've been engaged for like 2 years.
This ratcheted it up, Sam, because now they're like, what if we all die? We better get married. It's like getting married before you go off to war.
And this... is going to significantly change his life big time. Like, this is better than any...
I mean, instantly you're driving around in a Bentley.
Well, now you are accompanying Scarlett Johansson to all the A-list. Like, you are going to...
You get
to
nothing but the best.
Cannes Film Festival and, you know, wherever, Europe, and you're doing the yacht, and then there's, Brad Pitt.
Wow,
and
you really sold that.
I'm just saying.
You
like,
do Cannes Film Festival, you do the yacht, and Brad Pitt, and whole nine.
That's like that level.
Yeah,
like,
I know what you mean.
Of where that big, fat, rapey movie producer, what's his name?
What you were talking about.
Like, that guy used
Roman Polanski?
No.
Weinstein?
The Weinstein, like the you start doing things like that, like the ultra A-list,
like you're
list.
On a private island somewhere.
Yeah, you're now with the best of the best, right? Just because your wife is in that category.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's
Do you leave SNL?
No.
I'd quit. 100% I'd quit. I'd just be like, whatever you need done, I'll just do it.
Yeah, because he's got, I'm sure...
I'll carry your handbags.
Ambition to...
well, I have ambition too, Tom. But... I'm $165 million would outweigh any ambition I could ever scrape out of my body.
The prenup excludes him from any of that money.
No. That's why I'm going to work really hard in this relationship and quit SNL and just be at her beck and call.
That, listen, me too, buddy.
No problem.
I wish that.
It's another election year. I got to write more jokes. Not going to do it. I'm just going to hang out with Scarlett Johansson.
Yeah.
Drive this Bentley around.
Yeah. You start writing a screenplay that takes 10 years. Yeah. And you're just like, I'm still working on it. It doesn't even matter. Like, with that kind of money, it's just insane. Never worry about anything forever.
Yeah. It's great.
Good.
Hey, that was a good porking.
Bye-bye. Welcome back to A Corporate Time with Tom and Dan. I'm Tom.
I am Dan, and I just ate wild mushroom soup with a fork.
Yeah. We don't have any spoons here at TND Media.
Because Dr. Bob took them all.
We're a fork-only establishment.
Oh, yeah, all
There's
the forks.
There's a while we only had spoons.
But we didn't need them,
I had to eat my salads with spoons.
We never seem to have the right implement. Like, no. I thought about using two knives, like melted
chopsticks
together. I was going to melt two knives and then use the melted part of the plastic and push them together to form a small trough and then use my knife trough. But I was afraid that the burning end of the plastic would give me some disease. But then I remembered we're all going to get COVID, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And then I just ate it with a fork.
You could drink it. We'll have to put that. Alexa, add some shoes.
I would like to add shoes to my soup, please.
I was about to say, add spoons to my shopping list. Do we have that?
Butler, put spoons on the list.
Got
it. And I want the metal one.
You got a super expensive Alexa. It's Butler.
I want.
But doesn't remember the list.
Right.
So it's good.
Butler, put spoons on the list. What? I'm smoking weed.
All right. So every once in a while, we talk to someone who does a grand adventure, and I love it because I live vicariously through that person.
A grand adventure.
And, of course, like we talk to Jenna Hurd all the time about her grand adventure.
Yeah.
So, And then
I actually just talked to her over the weekend.
And then anybody who like maybe paddle boards down the Mississippi or takes a John boat down the intercoastal from New York.
And they almost die.
Yeah, or
and
a kayak.
Girlfriend gets pulled under Samuel Clement's steamboat.
And then I saw on our BDM page, a BDM posted a picture of a map and basically outlined. It looked like it was outlined the entire state of Texas.
And it reminded me of like when people take bike rides to try and spell their wife's name around Orlando.
Okay. Yeah.
Where they make a heart.
I hate that. Yeah,
I hate that too. So immediately when I saw this person's Texas outline, I hated it.
Yeah.
But then I had to dig a little deeper to unhate myself.
And he made a post saying, look, I just finished my bicycle ride around the entire state of Texas.
Yeah, the parameter of Texas.
The entire parameter, like literally outlining the actual
state.
Do
we say parameter or we say perimeter?
Well, I say parameter.
You're Sam Param, and you're
is it perimeter
Tim,
parameter?
And you're Tim Param.
It's perimeter.
Perimeter.
Sorry,
but I'm parameter.
Yeah, you're southern.
Southern trash. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Parameter.
Well, you just have you.
She said parameter.
Correcting me on the BDM
show. Manism.
She said parameter. She's also eating a Tapatico pickle from right out of the old barrel.
So anyway, we've got BDM Aaron on the line. How you doing, Aaron? Aaron, are you there?
Oh, no.
Parameter!
Do you hear me?
Yeah, now we got you.
All right. Sorry about that.
No problem.
What happened?
So, Aaron...
Did you drop your parameter?
I was riding my bike, sorry.
Oh,
man. Nothing stops you from riding.
Can't stop cycling.
Yeah, my God. You're a cycling machine.
So, let's start from the beginning. What caused you to come up with the idea to ride around the perimeter of Texas?
Why'd you say caused?
Man, I don't know. Maybe some people... Hold on, I'll explain, because a lot of times when people do these grandiose adventures, like, for instance, the guy that paddleboarded down the Mississippi...
Yeah. Matt Crofton.
He almost died from bat doo-doo, and then, like, when he spent a bunch of time in the hospital recovering, like, a near-death experience, and that caused him to say, like, I don't have...
You risk know, his life again.
I want to do an adventure.
I want to eat all the bat doo-doo.
It made his life perspective, it changed, and he went out to do a great adventure. So, did you... have some doo-doo poisoning, or what happened?
Oh, what kind of
do you have cancer or bat doo-doo poisoning?
What kind of doo-doo did you eat?
There are a lot of bats around here, but we were out last year. I was riding my bike on every single street in Austin, so I was doing another adventure last year. And when I was finishing that project, I thought I want to do something bigger, something that hasn't been done on my bike, and Texas is crazy about Texas. I thought I'd try to ride, circumnavigate the entire state.
Was it easy to do it with roads to go over the entire perimeter? Or was it difficult to find roads that would link up to what looks like a cartoon Texas perimeter?
Yeah, it was not too easy. And if you look at the map, there's some chunks where it's like, hey, you didn't actually hit the entire perimeter. And I just kind of went where the good roads were, as close as I could to the border of Texas.
Go where the good roads are.
It wasn't always possible.
So, Aaron, let's back up a little bit, because I need to understand why you're doing these things. Because I've seen this before, where now it's become a social media thing, where people go and document their adventures, or they'll say like, "Hey, I'm gonna one wheel from here to Maine," or what
they'll
proclaim.
Well, there's a guy on a ruckus that I follow that's been doing it for 2 years, and he's just been going all over the entire world
and then
on a tiny scooter.
You can make a living just off your social media and documenting your adventure, and therefore you gain followers, and then you start selling ads. And then you're able to make a little bit of money, and some people, I imagine, they've actually made a lot of money just by doing adventures and documenting them on social media.
Oh yeah.
So, Aaron, is this a social media thing? Like you said, you rode around all those roads in Austin. Like, why'd you even do that?
That was because someone I was following on Instagram, basically a runner in San Francisco, did it in San Francisco in like 70 days, but he's a professional runner. Ricky Gates, and he kind of after he was finished, he challenged everyone to do it in their towns or their zip codes or just their neighborhoods. So I decided to try on my bike. And
Hey, what's up? It's me, Ricky King. And I want to challenge you to a personal challenge.
Who does it?
I want you to ride every street in your zip code, and that's coming from me, Mr. Positivity, Ricky Gates.
I hate internet challenges.
And also, hey, guys, it's me, Ricky Gates. Before you go out on your bike challenge, let me just tell you, you got a civic duty to do, so get out there and rock the vote.
I will make a proclamation right now, I will never do an internet challenge. I'm just saying
that. Hey, what's up, Tom?
Never,
Tom, it's Ricky Gates.
Ever. Even people call me out, tag me in all your internet challenges, I will never do it. I mean, I do not get shamed by it. I look, I see it. Of course, you tag me, but I will just pretend like I didn't, and you'll never know, and then...
Aren't you going to do the fire challenge for the boy with no bones?
Yeah, pour water in my head, fire challenge,
it's the fire
push-ups.
Challenge.
That'll stink.
It's the cinnamon ice fire challenge. For the boys with no bones.
So this leads me to my second question, Aaron. You must have the schedule that lends itself to do these types of things because a normal person that's busy with life and work can't just stop
that's
what they're doing
for 2 months
and ride their bike around every street in Austin or around the perimeter of Texas. So are you independently wealthy? Are you self-employed? Do you have an open schedule? You're not doing the too much?
Homeless with a cell phone?
Yeah, the homeless
There's
with a cell
lot
phone.
Of homeless with a cell phone.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
That's like a whole, like there's like
Rob
white
Greenfield,
people, black people, Asian people, Latin people, homeless with a cell phone.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like its own race now.
Yeah, I work for Texas Monthly, a magazine here in Texas, and we're all working from home anyway right now, and
It's a good magazine. You work for a magazine called Texas Monthly?
In this issue of Texas Monthly, how to keep the shine on your boots and keep Obama from taking your guns.
Hey, what's in Texas Monthly? Because
you're not going to want to miss these really scandalous photos of George W. Bush's butt.
I'm not joking. When we went to Colorado, we stayed in my father-in-law's house. He's got a spread of Gun and Garden magazine.
Yeah.
Hey. Grow the flowers and blow their heads off.
And I was like, Gun and Garden? And I literally, as high as balls, I started reading it, and I was like, it's begonias.
It's two awesome things.
Begonias and ARs.
I grew this pineapple, and then I just threw it in the air and Desert Eagled it.
Like, what a bizarre Gun and Garden.
I love it.
And I'm like, this looks like a parody magazine of like someone who would be making a joke about. Anyway, so Texas Monthly, you have a job that apparently you can just do whatever you want.
Wait, what's your department at Texas Monthly? Are you a writer?
I do write about beer, and now it's cycling for them, yes.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah, the beer and cycling guy.
Because just like if you're a social media entertainer or whatever.
Yeah, but he's the fluff piece.
But
so, you know what I mean? Exactly. Like all the other guys are writing about, you know, like the legislative, local Texas politics,
immigrants.
What's going on, our guns, the walls, this is a great IPA, and you'll love to do wheelies in this parking lot.
Oh, yeah, you're the snowflake at Texas Monthly.
They hate you.
Yeah.
I thought you guys were supposed to check your guns at the door. Shut up.
Pretty much.
So you're able to actually do these things and then write about them. So technically, it's kind of under the terms of work. You know, this is because you're writing about your life.
I think this would be a good story for Texas Monthly. Mm. You know, the old...
Right, well, I'm technically in the production department, so I don't work in the edit department. I freelance write for them on the side.
Gotcha.
Okay. So, all right. So, you got a open job that allows you to have some time to do these types of things. So, let's start about the planning. When you're riding your bicycle around Texas, do you have any idea how long that will, you know, that's going to take? Like, based on you could do this many miles a day, like, how long was the whole trip supposed to be?
Yeah. I knew I could get about 2 months off, not off, but, you know, 2 months. Anything over that, they think I'm insane anyway. But I would just, do about 50-something miles a day. So I planned it out, like, from this town to this town, this far. You know, I check out the roads on Google Street View, and I kind of mapped out a plan for 56 to 58 days of riding.
Hold on, Aaron. I'm laughing a little bit because you're like, I knew I can get 2 months. Any day over 2 months would be asking for 2 months. Yeah. 2 months? Who can do that? I'm talking to Bicycle Butler over here. Anything over 2 months off, they might get a little angry that their employee
is taking 2 months. Look at him go, it's two-wheeled up.
I mean, if someone was gone from work for 2 months, I would assume that's it. Never coming back. But if they came back, I'd be like, what?
My wife thinks it's weird if I'm, like, gone for 20 minutes and she hasn't heard from me. You know what I mean? Like, it's weird.
Yes. So,
well, I foolishly thought I could get 2 months off, and then it ended up working.
And then, like, COVID halfway through, like, you're going down the bottom of Texas, and they call you. They're like, yeah, you're fired. And you're like, oh, crap. I'm right at the second Eagle Wing.
I'm near Mexico. I'm just going to go in. I'm just going to start riding south.
I found
south.
A donkey, so it's my new friend.
So you were trying to plan this out to do it in 2 months. Was it, based on mileage per day, would it be even possible to ride around the perimeter of Texas in 2 months?
Yeah. I figured it out, and that's what it took to do it. I was hoping I could do it shorter, but, I would have to be riding 150 miles a day, which is not possible for me. So,
what kind of bike are you doing this on, and are you dressed in, like, the
Mungus.
Full... Are you dressed in, like, the full zip-up, riding kit?
No, I wore some Lycra bike shorts sometimes, but I didn't really have jerseys. I wore T-shirts mostly.
Okay, but you're are you on a standard road bike?
It's what they call a gravel bike, which is like a road bike. It's kind of between a road bike and a mountain bike. It's got bigger tires. Yeah,
gotcha.
What's the weather like? Is it blazing hot while you're riding around Texas?
It started out blazing hot. I started in September down in South Texas, but by the time I got out to West Texas, it was at 40s at night.
Oh,
so
my God.
Really nice.
So,
were you down in the West Texas town of El Paso?
God, I sure was.
I screwed it up. It's hard to say.
So, Aaron, now people that have some money to put into these adventures, like they'll get a car to follow them, along
like
cars,
a crew
to help them along the way.
Bike breaks down, some guy pulls up, hands you a new bike, and off you go.
Yeah, and then they'll have all your areas that you're going to sleep and your meals planned out. Was it just you by yourself, or did you have any help?
The majority of the time, it was just me, and I was eating at gas stations.
Diarrhea.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
The roids.
Yeah, it was pretty bad. And but out in West Texas, my brother-in-law came from California and drove with me. So he gave me some support through some of the desert and stuff like that.
So basically, now did he have to just ride in front of you, going super slow, bicycle speed on the right-hand lane, or
No. We would meet up down the road. He'd be like, "Oh, I'll be 20 miles down the road." So
you just sit there in his car and watch Mandalorian?
Hold on, how boring!
This is not an adventure, Tom.
At least the crazy people that followed Forrest Gump was running with him.
Yeah.
They were experienced.
And who is this? Your brother? He rides up ahead of you. He pulls over. He's like, "I'm just gonna." Oh, Mando, you're the best. He's watching Mandalorian.
So he's just driving 20 miles ahead. Just sits in the Walmart parking lot waiting
for
him.
And he's like, "Hey, you want a power X? You got diarrhea? Okay, well, I'm gonna go 20 more miles."
How is that fun for him, and how is that supportive to you?
It's not supportive. It's mean. It reminds you that you could not be doing this and living a better life.
It probably wasn't that fun for him, but made time, cut up oranges for me, made some coffee, things like that.
Oh, so you're basically Tom to his son.
Yeah, so you had a butler.
So now, did you plan out where you were going to stay, and where did you stay? Did you stay in hotels and tents? I imagine hotels would get expensive as hell.
Or did you just stay in any Four Season resort you could find with a wave pool?
Did you bring your own supplies on your bike? Were there any rules to this? Were you trying to break a record by someone else? Or, I'm sure this has been done before because everything has been done.
Wow, wait a minute. Crap on this guy's idea.
Answer all 20 questions.
Okay. I camped about a quarter of the time, so I was carrying my sleeping bag, a tent, things like that. And then the other times I'd stay in hotels, and luckily I'm able to expense that to the magazine. I mean, nice. I haven't been paid for that yet, but I'm
wait till the expense reports come out.
Oh my God.
Your boss.
Don't hold your fake adventure breath.
I imagine the chief and editor of Texas Monthly isn't some snowflake. He's a big bell buckle.
He is a rotund, powerful man with a big voice, and he gives great hugs. But he is a bottom line money man.
And for sure he's gonna be. I didn't pay for this GD snowflake to ride on Texas, and I'm paying for it.
I didn't pay for you to make your calves bigger on my dollar.
So you had some expense, like obviously they paid for the hotels because it was part of
what are you saying, like Red Roof Inn or like Best Western?
Exactly.
Yeah. Those are kind of fun.
La Quinta.
Did you have any uncomfortable encounters on your travels? Did you sneak any ladies into the hotel and show them what a real adventurer can do?
My brother-in-law might have, not me. My wife would have been too happy. But back to Tom's question about someone that's done it before. As far as I knew, no one had done this before.
In your face, Tom.
Why would they? So
there you go. In your face, Tom.
Well, hold on. Hold on. I'm just thinking that someone has decided to ride around Texas on a bicycle because, okay, other bicycle feats, people have ridden from one coast to another. That's
they do it
common.
All the time.
Yeah. And then I imagine that someone's maybe ridden around the perimeter of the entire United States.
Yes.
You know, that's maybe something. I imagine someone's ridden from Miami to Alaska. That's a popular motorcycle ride. Yep. So I imagine a bicycle. So I'm just venturing a guess that someone's been like, I'm going to ride around. Because, okay, let's talk about mileage. The state of Texas is gigantic, so the perimeter, just mileage-wise, how many miles is that?
For me, it ended up being 3,014 miles. So it's a lot. Now, when I got back, there was a claim from someone who said their father did it twice in 2000 and 2006, I think. But he also said that he didn't go down into the Big Bend area, which is, you know, southwest Texas. So I'm still claiming I'm the first person to do it.
All right. But claiming and actually being...
You need to get certified somehow. Well, how can we do that?
Is there anywhere on... If you do a quick Google search, man bicycles around
right
Texas...
Right now, I've already started looking. It's just him.
Oh, really? Oh, you may be.
I'm saying I'm on the first page of Google, and it just happened. So, you know.
Big Texas.
But I did find a website called Texas Distance Challenge. Are you up for the challenge, Tom? For the Texas Distance Challenge?
I don't know what that is.
That sounds
like a sex thing.
I think that...
That was a virtual challenge.
Which is what Tom
hate all those virtual challenges.
So now 3,000 miles, that's longer than it would be if you went from the Atlantic Ocean to the Pacific Ocean, right? Like I think that's only
depends on which route you take, but there are some routes that are longer, but there are some routes that are shorter. So
okay.
Did you run into any strange people or any bad hombres?
No bad hombres. I didn't run into any of that, thankfully. So that's pretty good for 58 days to have no major run-ins with.
What's your wife doing during all of this? I mean, you're like, hey, I work for Texas Monthly, babe. I'm out. I'm gonna cycle
two
around
months
here
straight.
On my gravel bike, and you don't have any kids.
She's taking care of my two kids.
Oh my God.
This guy's living the life. Hold on. This guy is living the life. He's got 2 months off.
This is better Daniel Bicycle Man.
His job is paying him to stay at La Quinta's. He doesn't have to watch his
kids. How does this guy do this? How does this conversation go with your wife? Like, literally.
Are you with her? Can we talk to her?
I got
to
start buttering my wife up months in advance for a thing I want to do on the weekend. Like, if I have a fantasy football draft.
I really just wanted to go to Aruga's and have some wings.
I want to get an S face at my fantasy football draft. For months, I'm going to be like, hey, I'm going to do this draft. And then I got to do it long enough where she's like, oh, okay. Because she's not going to get mad because it's 2 months away. And then I mention it every the day off. She's still mad. And I'm leaving. I'm like, I'm sorry.
It's a huge fight.
I'll be back as soon as possible. She's like, I'm not happy about it. That's a fantasy football draft. How did this conversation go?
It was a gradual conversation. It was over a month, and it eventually ended up with if your work says it's okay, then I guess it's okay with us. So
how old are your kids?
They're son's 11 and my daughter's 8.
All right, so
they're a little older. Okay, I was gonna say if it's like it's two twin 2 year olds, I was gonna be like, you're a bastard.
Although, like, are they doing like virtual school? Like, it's probably
I
a nightmare.
Think about that. Yeah. Oh my god,
not in Texas.
Does your wife work?
Not in Texas.
Does your wife work?
They are doing virtual school, and my wife just started working last week. You know, she's
a liberal part
work.
Of Texas. Yeah. I was like, I mean, Texas is virtually oil Florida. Aaron, what about, okay, this has always bothered me, and it's also bothered me when Forrest Gump was running across the world. I don't like it. When people do grandiose adventures, but don't listen to any earbuds of stuff.
Yeah, they're just in their own head.
They're in their own head their whole time, and they talk about how great that is. I was like, it sounds miserable. The whole time, you never listen to earbuds or music or
anything?
Come on, Gump. You just ran thinking about what? Nothing?
Jenny, the whole time.
Because it's the same monotonous. I'm sure that Texas is just flat, so it's just over. You're just riding down desert roads of miles and miles of nothing.
Yeah, it sounds boring as hell.
So what, did you entertain yourself? Did you listen to us? Anything?
Wow, you didn't read his post.
I listen to podcasts. I listen to music. The worst was when my Bluetooth headphones would die in the middle of a ride, and I had nothing to listen to. So.
It's your brother, Eddie. Yeah, you have some backup.
Yeah, well, he's 20 minutes up the road, and he's using his earbuds to watch Mandalorian, and he's not giving them up. He's like, this is a hell of an opening for the second season.
He said he caught up on BDM shows and Corporate Time shows while he was... cycling around for 58 days.
That's why I like Aaron, because you're different than the Gumps of the world. You actually can entertain yourself while you're doing something.
I noticed you didn't mention that in Texas Monthly, though.
Put us in there. I want to be in Texas Monthly. Put our picture in there.
So
these are the guys that kept me alive, the real heroes.
So speaking of like making the route of the entire trip, you had to stick with back roads, right? Like, did you ever have to go off-road or, like, find yourself lost?
A tire or something?
Did you plan the next leg of the next day? I mean, or was it just keep on going? I mean, was it kind of willy-nilly?
It was all pre-planned, but I did, you know, the night before, I would check the route just to see where I was going. And then I had a bike computer you can put your directions into, it gives you turn-by-turn directions. But mostly you're riding, like a lot of times, you're just riding one road the entire day. It's pretty much straight. And they weren't always small back roads. Sometimes they're highways. At one point I was on I-10. So it depends on where you were in the state.
Do you ever get hassled by police or being on a road you shouldn't have been?
No, I mean, every road I was on... was fine for my cyclists. I mean, they weren't perfect, but I mean, they were allowed.
Did your wife ever mention the fact that this is probably extremely dangerous, and just from the amount of time on busy roads?
Well, cycling's just dangerous.
Yeah, especially like road cycling, like, you know.
He wasn't wearing a helmet.
No helmet? Oh, it's Texas. I forgot. Oil floor.
He wore a cowboy hat.
did she ever worry about the danger of it? Because one teen girl that's texting could clip you at 60 and lights are out.
And no red roof in for you. Pull your feet right off. And she's in a big old truck, my God.
Sometimes I've zoomed past bicyclists and I'm like, my God, how are you not freaking out? Like, I went by you 40 miles an hour in my truck. If I wasn't paying attention and I hit you, you're dead.
Oh, I know.
Instantly dead.
I hit a couple. I was like, I think I killed him. I could have sworn I killed him. I just,
I saw the blood.
I had somewhere to be. It was raining.
So, what about the danger?
Yeah. I mean, the danger is what it is. I mean, when you decide to do this, you're just taking on that danger, and Sophia, my wife, understands that. And, yeah, she was worried, obviously.
Wait a minute. You said Sophia, my wife, as if she slid a piece of paper and said, you better say Sophia.
Yeah, well, I apologize, Aaron, but, like, there's certain things, like, when...
I like that name, Sophia.
When someone has to go and do a tour in Afghanistan, and, like, the whole family's like, I accept the danger, this is part of the job, but this is what you signed up for, you know, it's super dangerous, I could die, but this
it's
is
crazy.
What... This is...
That's the thing.
This is the tax to this job.
That's the thing.
Now, when you're just doing a stunt for Texas Monthly, and
wait a minute. I think you came up with more for him, wasn't he?
It's not like they forced you to do it. Like your job was on the line.
Right. Better get the scoop on this perimeter thing.
Yeah, or it's not like you're doing you're doing some duty for America or some sort of.
You weren't delivering a special package,
or even getting paid a bunch of money. Like it's not like Texas Monthly's like, we'll pay you $1 million if you could do this, and your family's like, all right, you have to do it for the money.
Or dare I say. Charity?
or to save
you
some
kids. You could have done it for charity. You could have been not been a selfish ass.
It seems like a dad that wants to go and ride his bicycle for 2 months and then get his hotels paid for. And if I was your wife, I'd be like, hell no, you're not doing this garbage and you're staying here. I'm not going to let you go and just be away from the family, live your life for 2 months and have an adventure and we're here, I'm taking care of the kids, getting them dressed for school, and you're just going to go out and they're all paying for just hotels? It's going to be more expensive than that.
Oh my God, it's almost as if you've heard this before. Holy crap, that was good Sophia.
Because for sure you spend your own money on food and some other stuff, and who knows, I mean, I imagine you're a BDM, you do drugs.
Yeah, how did you handle drugs and masturbation while you're on this strange trip?
I handled them fine.
You were high the whole time, weren't you?
I think you were just driving to brewery or cycling to breweries the whole time.
Did you get loaded at all?
Yeah, especially when my brother-in-law was in town, with me. We just, there's not much to do in some of these towns, so you just drink in the hotel.
Was it me, or did you hear him go, oh, Jesus? That's what it sounded like. That's what it sounded like he said.
So,
coming out.
Speaking of, did you have an end of the trip tally of how much money this took? Because I'm sure, you had to buy some extra bike tires, some equipment.
Some socks.
All the food. My God, eating out
for
2 months. Could you imagine how expensive it is just to eat out for 2 months? Because it's not like you...
I haven't eaten out in 7 months. I don't know what to tell you.
Well, it's just you buying all your food. So what was the end of the trip tally?
I just know that my credit card bills are higher now than they have been in years. So,
oh my God,
I don't want to see the tally. It's done. It's happened. It was expensive.
So you,
I mean, it cost you at least $5,000, I bet. And when it's all said and done, right? I mean,
I bet more.
Yeah, I mean, I would think more. But I'm saying, even if you budgeted it, $5,000 in food. I'm not even counting lodging. I'm just talking about $5,000 in food and extra parts and you're around. You're gonna spend some money in entertainment, something. Yeah. Like you're gonna buy some stuff and little things.
You go to a strip club. And
So you go home.
That is sad. If you get a lap dance and then you walk out and get on your bike and continue down the road on your adventure, that's sad.
I will say the saddest part of these grandiose adventures
is when they end.
Yes, because a lot of the times, unless you're famous and the news media has followed you and there's a bunch of people at the finish line,
nobody cares.
You end your trip and there's no one there. Your wife is waiting in the car mad because you did this.
I'm here to pick you up. You son of a bitch.
And there's no one cheering. That's part of the what you pay for when you do Ironman and triathlons and stuff. You pay for there's an audience at
the
end.
They pump that in too. It's like Falcon Stadium.
So when you cross the finish line, having people cheer for you, it's like an ending to an adventure that you want.
Was anybody cheering for you?
Yeah. How'd the ending go, buddy?
Yeah, it was pretty sad. No, there's plenty of people there for me when I ended.
But just your family, right?
You knew everybody's first name.
Mostly family.
It was your Trumpy uncle. There's this is gay.
He was there.
Anybody from Texas Monthly?
He was there. A couple of the Texas Monthly IT guys are there.
The chief and
great
editor.
Job, Iron Butt. We were with you the whole time.
Yeah, they're live. It's just
what's been going on at the... Oh, they don't like you very much. I'm sorry. Your desk has got a lot of white stuff all over it.
Did anybody from Texas Monthly come out? Who exactly was there?
Was Mr. Monthly there?
No. No one from Texas.
No one? Not, no. That's the punchline.
Not one coworker
not
or someone?
One, not one.
Well, I have to say, I ended in Brownsville, and our offices are in Austin, which is 6 hours away. So not exactly.
That's bad planning on your part.
And they all said they crossed their arms. They're like, I'm not going to Brownsville.
Yeah. Oh,
that's not
buddy.
The first time they said that.
No, it's not.
They literally say it all the time. I didn't even know the town was called
Brownsville.
That's
the least visited place by any of us.
So you ended it 6 hours away. Couldn't you end it at the
office?
At
you should ride into the office and then do that thing where you're stunt biking and you're jumping over the desks until you land on your desk and then you're balancing.
Yeah, haven't you seen the Red Bull guy? His videos are awesome.
Yeah.
Austin is in the center of the state, so it wouldn't work out for the perimeter. So.
Well, you know, you start from there, you go to the perimeter,
and then
go back.
Cut back
what's
in
what's a couple? What's a you know?
Yeah.
100
so
extra
six
miles.
6 hours after you've been riding for 2 months.
Yeah. So you end. Is there a finish line? Do they chalk something up?
Yeah, at a mall, he rode into a finish line.
Did they put a checkered? Did they with chalk a checkered flag or something? Was there a point?
A medal, and you broke through a ribbon.
They had one of those banners for me to ride through, but I decided I didn't want to ride through because I was afraid I'd fall off the bike.
No, you didn't even ride through the banner? No. Just ride through the banner.
It's a Dots Matrix banner. It says, like, happy birthday and Helvetica.
And then you get in the car and just drive home.
Because you're exhausted.
Yeah, and your wife's mad. Your kids.
What do you want for dinner? I was going to have fish sticks and a salad.
Your kids went through their birthdays by themselves.
We missed your daddy.
Yeah, they're 2 months older. And at that age, like, you can tell the difference. Like, you're like, oh my God, you've grown.
We've been having a guy stay over here every other night. He's great. We call him Roger.
So, at the end, have you written the actual article for Texas Monthly yet?
Yeah, I did a weekly article every, so there's 8 of them right now.
Ah, okay.
At the website.
So it was a kind of an ongoing blog. Did they even
hold on?
Was it just for the internet version, or they didn't even publish it?
It's a good website.
Digital only is the cop out, man. Yeah. That's like a digital billboard. It's not even real.
Yeah.
And people buy it. You think it's real? It's not real. It's not real until it's on paper.
It changes every 3 seconds. Oh my God.
I was just there. I swear to God. Now it's a chiropractor.
So you did this all for a blog? Not even, you don't even have anything to frame?
It was like a tweet.
Like,
I'm sure with the success of the blog, they'll put something in print.
It's already gone. It's already lost its luster. You're done with it.
Because there's an old man that did it in 2006.
Yeah. And there's also a bunch of copycat people that have, like, done it already faster than you have. And they've done it, like, nonstop.
Oh.
Like, there's people beating your records currently. So by the time they're never going to publish it now, Aaron. God.
Yeah, it's true. It's true.
So, what'd you learn from this, Aaron? Because
I hate that question.
He probably learned not to call into our show. Number one.
Well, you knew that from listening to all this. You listened to us do this to other people.
Yes.
Why'd you do it, Aaron?
He also learned that Sophia is very nice and a lovely wife.
Yeah.
Who is very patient.
Nice, nicer wife.
Lovely.
Than my God.
Italian
I didn't know
beauty.
That existed. I'm going to ask you the question you hate, because all these other adventures we talked to, like, for instance, Rob Greenfield, we talked to him about he walked from Brazil to, like, Arizona or something.
Well, that's not even the adventure I thought. The other adventure was, like, I'm going to starve myself for 4 years because I can't find food.
But he talked about, he learned that humanity was nice and most people are nice.
But he could have been delirious.
That's my stock answer, is that people are nicer than you think. But, like, everyone that stopped me and asked me what I was doing, whenever I told them, they'd always say, oh, you need some water? Or, you know, people helped me out with some people gave me a place to stay, things like that. So, I mean,
hey,
there are a lot
here's
of
a copy of Guns and Garden magazine. Keep you occupied.
So you stayed in some stranger's house? They let you just...
No. They owned a motel, and they let me stay there.
Ooh, Texas motel.
I've always wanted to stay in, like, a stranger's house.
Did you make any friends along the way? Did anybody start, like, gumping you and following you in the bike? You know, I'm saying, like, some other cyclist heard about you in Texas
I'll
Monthly.
I'll ride with you to the border.
Yeah, yeah. And then they go on legs of the trip. That happened with
Matt Crofton
and like other people that have done this. You get tag-alongs that go on small portions of the adventure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had a day from my ride from Marshall to Texarkana. Two guys came out and ride with me. When I was up in the panhandle of Texas, there's like three guys that came out and rode with me. My friend from Austin came out to West Texas and rode with me. I did meet people along the way.
But you made no friends. I like that.
No friends.
I like that. I like that he's like, I did this for 2 months, met no one of significance.
Learned nothing, met no one.
Wife's a little mad. Yeah. I spent way more money than my credit card debt.
$20,000 in debt, no friends, wife's mildly mad, kids think I don't care about them, and I own digital only. Well done.
Yeah, I got to tell you, Aaron, usually I want to talk to people about these adventures because I live with the
this one was a bad idea.
Are you a different person now? Did you
change your life?
And then at the end, we're like, we ask you a question, and you're like, I don't like that question. Like,
do you value your time more? Do you respect the earth more? Do you
do you love Texas more?
Do you love Texas more? That's good. That's a good question. Where do you stand on Texas?
Texas is a great place. Mm-hmm. Best place to live. Mm-hmm. Tom, I'm going to do Florida next, so I'm assuming you're going to come out and ride with me too, right?
Well,
did you hear about his wife?
I'll ride with you. I'll ride a little bit. I'll ride through Orlando.
If you turn down that money, will you come right in front of Daniel's house? Because he'll ride at the end of the block.
Well, then I'll be puking the whole time.
He'll start at the end of the block. He'll ride to his house.
You're
not going anywhere.
I can give you a solid two pedals, and then I coast for a long time.
Yeah. I'll reach out and give you a tiny paper cup of water triangle.
Just send Tommy out.
Yeah. Do you want to drink water out of a cone cup? I got one for you. So it doesn't sound like this changed you in any great way, or you got some sort of introspection.
A lot of people that do these things are younger, and they're looking for themselves. I mean, I'm 40. I'm 41 now, and I have a family. So I'm pretty formed mentally and everything. So once I did it, the idea was to do it. I wasn't looking for myself. So
what were you looking for?
Like, all right,
you're
going to
never get away from your family for 2 months.
Is that what it was? Is that what it boils down to?
And have Texas Monthly pay for your hotel.
Is that what it was?
Yeah, it was like a two-month, like, you know, like sort of like a meditation. That's
Aaron,
what it sounds like.
This is brilliant, by the way. Like, I wish we need to all con our employers.
Somebody's been doing that.
Are you insane? Yeah,
Bicycle Baller.
Yeah, Bicycle Baller's done it, but my wife would never let me do that.
Yeah, you found a way to have the company you work for pay for an adventure of yours. I'll write about it in your blog. All right, Aaron.
That was interesting.
Yeah. And did you ever come close at all to like getting hit by a car or being mugged?
You ever had a bottle thrown in your head?
Yeah. Any danger at all?
You get passed by cars super close, but nothing. I never got actually like grazed or anything, but it came pretty close a lot of times, so
all right.
I was pretty lucky.
Fast car drove for pretty close to you. Out of all,
I could feel the wind.
But by the way, it goes to show you that we live in a pretty safe country. If you can just ride your bike around the entire state,
3,000 miles, no big deal.
Not even have a person look at you wrong, or like you even think that you're going to get robbed.
Not
or,
bad at all.
Someone didn't try to steal anything from you or scam you in any way. You rode around the entire state of Texas and didn't encounter any problems.
Oh, I have to get a little snowflakey. I mean, I am a white man riding around.
That's true.
It's a lot easier, I think, for me than other people.
Yeah,
I get to understand that. That's not right. I get it.
Good
luck with your new Florida adventure. Get a hold of us when you do that. I'll ride with you a little bit, man, for sure. I will. Love riding.
Are you serious or are you joking around?
Well, no, I mean, I grew up in Florida and my parents still live there. So if I'm going to do another one, that's probably where I'd go.
Two more months away from the kiddos.
All right.
Keep doing this, you're going to skip a whole year of their life.
Yeah. How long will it take you to ride around Florida?
Shorter than 2 months, but I don't think Texas Monthly will pay for it.
Yeah, how about Florida Monthly?
Yeah, to go to Orlando Sentinel.
Yeah. Orlando Weekly won't. Oh, man. My God.
Yeah, Sentinel definitely won't. They're sending my GD old paper bill to collections, and they're calling me every day to try to get me to sign up again.
$35.
They just called me in the bathroom. All right, Aaron. Well, I'm glad you had a safe adventure, and I'm still kind of jealous, even though it sounds horrible.
I would do it.
I'm missing that quintessential adventure. How old are you, Aaron?
41.
I'm 41. I turned 41 on the trip.
I still got time. I could still do my family adventure. Maybe we should call Crystal and ask if I could do...
What's your family adventure?
Well, no, I meant adventure without my family.
Oh, individual.
Don't say family adventure.
I'm pulling an Aaron.
Without my family adventure.
No.
If you said to Crystal, family adventure, she's in.
They are annoying. Super annoying. Aaron, could you imagine if you went with your whole family, how much worse it would be?
Oh, my God.
Right, the first week I was with the family, and it wasn't so bad because I just ride during the day and they would go to the beach.
Hold on, that's even worse because at least...
I still don't understand why you did this. You got people following you, but they're not following you. They're like going and partying and you're just torturing yourself. All right, we got to go.
Yeah.
All right, bye-bye.
All right, see you, Aaron.
Nice guy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
That was a crazy... That's crazy.
Yeah.
No way in hell Andrea would let me do that.
You're not getting anything out of it, so why would she let you do that?
I guess if you said, like, you needed this for yourself and you wanted to accomplish this thing and, you know, your spouse was supportive of you, like, hey, I want to, you know, I have this dead set in my mind. But then there's going to be an answer of or a question of, like, yeah, but at what cost? At the cost of you leaving the family for 2 months? How about you do this when
and
the kids...
costing us money.
When the kids get, like, you're 18 or whatever.
Yeah,
like,
but you'll be too old to do it then.
Mm. I feel like if he's 47, you could, you know, not that different.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, I mean, he's just slowly riding his bicycle. I mean, there's old men that
You're just riding.
There's old men that do Ironman and stuff in their 60s and stuff like that. So it's possible. But yeah, it would be a little bit harder. I just, man, just to sell that prospect for no apparent reason.
It'd be very difficult. Yeah.
But cool. Welcome to A Corporate Time with Tom and Dan. I'm Tom.
I am Dan. Samantha and Butler are all here. I think the computer is finally dialed in the studio.
All right.
I'm feeling a little bit better, and welcome to the day.
So
today is the day that the Lord has made.
Remember?
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
I was going to say remember the 5th of November.
Oh, right. Mm-hmm. Remember when I told you guys I went to the eye doctor?
It's an optometrist.
Yeah. And then I was, you know, trying to guess the right
one or
thing.
Two. Robot butthole. Yeah.
Right.
And then they.
Now you do know we didn't fully believe that you actually went. That we thought maybe the whole thing was just a very detailed orchestrated lie.
Okay. No, I went and then. Then they ushered me out with dilated eyes to pick out my pair of glasses, and then the guy was going through all of them.
Did you pick some Dame Edna's?
Hello!
I didn't know. I was just like, you just tell me what
just
to buy.
Just give me the Mrs. Doubtfire.
I don't know.
I don't care anymore.
I trust you, glasses man.
Don't trust the glasses man.
Optometrist.
And then...
they're going to try and sell you the most expensive stuff.
Yeah.
Normally, it's ladies. I got a nice British lady at my place, and I go out there, and she's like, oh, hello, Mr. Dennis. Let's pick you out some spectacles.
So,
seriously, I love her. She's great.
Then
I got these. These are awesome. These are Pair Soles. That's a brand that I really, really like. And I've had these for about 10 years. And these are phenomenal. 10 years, those glasses right there.
So anyway, I was like, you got a bunch of glasses everywhere. Like, just, I thought I was going to leave with them that day. Like, yeah, I was like, I paid for them more money than I thought.
See, here's the thing is, you know, people that wear glasses, you don't have to buy the glasses there. You can just get the prescription and buy them online for cheap.
Yeah.
Which is what I do.
That's what my wife yelled at me about. Mm-hmm. Because she's like, never buy the glasses from there.
It's
never.
So expensive.
That's We've like
buying
through this. I
tires
told you.
From a dealership.
I told you, the only reason you would buy there and the reason I have in the past, and sometimes I haven't, is if my insurance covers it. My insurance doesn't cover it. I go someplace else. I take my prescription to go.
Anyway.
But I do like, what do you do? Like Zenny?
You're right.
Zenny, yeah.
Zell's the chase thing. Yeah, yeah. Zenny Optical.
Zenny Optical's dope, man.
So I was confused and overwhelmed by the whole experience.
Yeah. Yeah. You need a guardian with you at all times.
Were you a little bummed out because this is a definitive mark on the old headboard? You know, I mean, getting glasses. Oh, yeah. You can't look at me anymore and be like, "Oh, get your glasses," or this, that, and the other thing.
Okay, well, hold on,
because you, sir,
it's not.
You're ticking the box, man. So don't give me that anymore.
So the doctor said I don't really need these like every day.
Well, you don't need these, but we're just going to give them to you.
What's your prescription?
I don't even know. Oh, okay. But he said it's super small, and he's like, these are optional glasses, and you can wear
extra credit glasses.
I'm assuming you're farsighted?
Yeah.
Well, wait a minute. So
no,
why
nearsighted. I can't see far away.
So why are... I feel like...
It's like 2015 or something.
The only reason you're saying this is to defend the fact that you need glasses, or there'd be no reason to say it.
He said,
"I don't buy it. If you don't need them, then don't buy them."
Right.
Well, because I use them a lot to read, because I find
then you need them.
It's easier for me to
either
read.
You need them or you don't.
I can't even see the back of like super small print. Like it's impossible. I can't even.
Can you read this can of corn I'm holding right now?
Anyway,
so then you are farsighted.
No, but he says that
Gary Larson.
It's the because I'm a little bit nearsighted, and because I can't see things far
away. You're narsighted.
That it actually affects my reading because it causes this eye strain.
So you look through the book.
I don't know what he said. Anyway,
sounds like you're blind all around.
No,
you weren't really
fine.
Paying attention when he was explaining it to you.
He
right?
said you could use these, not use them, whatever you want.
Like a condom. I don't care. Either use it or don't. Feel
anyway,
better.
So I bought them, but I didn't get them that day. And
what kind of frames did you get?
I'll bring them
he
in
got
tomorrow.
Big gold David Koresh.
Are you sure you're going to get them tomorrow?
No, I already got. I picked them up. That's how I'm going to tell you the story about picking them up.
Are you
already
sitting on them right now? And there are 1,000 pieces in your pocket.
No,
okay.
That's the reason I didn't even leave the house with them, because I lose everything that I have.
Did you gotta get Horace Grant's.
You got to get the chain.
Yeah, you need Horace Grant's. You got to strap them on and put one of those. Remember back in the day, you'd put a croaky behind
even,
it, a stretchy neoprene croaky.
I can go without them. I don't even need them. But just,
well, then why do you have them? I'm going to keep saying that all day.
I've been seeing you for the past 3 weeks put on glasses every day.
Yeah, and they're leopard-striped Tiger King
glasses. They are Grandma Dollar General glasses.
They're Grandma. Well, they're like the Lady in the Rat Hat.
That's my business. That's my money counting
glasses.
No, those
are Lady in the Red Hat Club glasses. They're like what my grandma would wear when she's fancied up and going to a funeral.
Yeah. He told me not to wear those anymore. He's like, "What did you buy?" I'm like, "I don't know, just something on Amazon for $5."
The Tiger King magnification glasses.
He's like, "Don't do that." He's like, and I'm like, "Okay, I'm still doing it."
Of course, because I
need multiple pairs of these ones that I got.
Yeah, well, for God's sake, don't bring the ones that are special for your eyes.
As soon as I leave the house with them, they're gone. I know that.
Buy the other ones online, please. Yes, save yourself.
No, that's why you need the. That's why you need the rope around your neck.
Yeah, the chain.
I can't even remember to bring my watch to work.
I'm disabled. You don't bring your watch to work and then put it on.
I am mentally disabled. Okay. See, leave me alone.
Now that I can't say anything. It's like whenever anybody says that, I'm like, oh.
Yeah, but if you have the chain, it might help you.
No, I'm too disabled for the chain.
Okay.
You just too far gone. Anyway.
Put them on with your mask.
I get a text.
He doesn't wear masks.
Right,
I forgot.
That's right. Yeah, he doesn't believe in it.
I get a text. Can I borrow your glasses for a second?
Oh, I don't want them lost.
No.
Don't be losing my glasses. As soon as he touches them, they just materialize.
So I get a text like, "Hey, your glasses are done.
Hey,
come
it's
pick
Gary,
them up.
Your glasses are done."
So I'm like, "Oh, great." And I was on my way home, so I was like, "All right, cool. I'll just swing by and grab these glasses." So I stop by the place. I walk in. I go up to the front, and then I'm like,
"Where's everybody?" "We're right in front of you, sir."
I'm like, "I'm here to pick up my glasses, Tom Van." And then he says,
"That's really what you said?"
Well, they want
here for my glasses, Tom Van.
They want the name.
Yeah.
Normally there's a okay.
Yeah, because I know what they're going to ask me, so I'm just telling them. So then they say, "All right, sir, please have a seat. The glasses specials will be with you in a second." And I'm like,
You've named every person that works there incorrectly.
And I was like, "Well, just give them to me."
Right.
in a bag. No, I already paid for them.
They want you to inspect them to make sure that they're scratched.
Okay. Fit them to your
Check
head.
The coating. Then they put them on you. Then they adjust the nose piece.
Okay, this is what I wanted to ask you about.
Yeah, dude, this is a big deal. You're getting a pair of glasses to help your eyes, which are part of your body.
I didn't know that there was a whole song and dance attached to
this. It's a doctor, for Christ's sake.
I thought, just give me the GD glasses in a bag and let
it's
me be
not
on my
Walmart.
Way.
See, if you would have ordered them online, you'd have been... Showed up at your house.
Oh my god!
So they're like, "Please have," and then I'm like, "Okay." So I sit down, and then the glasses special is with someone else. So I'm like, "God damn!" I'm like, "Just give me the genie glasses. Get the get out of here."
You didn't say that though, because they would give them to you if you wanted them.
I could be shitting.
You would have said like, "Nope, I just want to take them. I don't need to be fitted."
No, too awkward for that. I just sit down, and then
I mean, he's so awkward. If they offered to put him in a condom and put him inside of him, he'd do it.
No,
you know what I mean? Because he'd be like, "I got him." I guess, God, I didn't know this was the way it's done, but if you say so, Doc.
So then,
are you clowning me?
I'm there too long, and I'm like antsy, and then the guy's done.
What is too long?
I'm there like
15 minutes?
8 to 9 minutes.
Whoa,
sitting there.
Holy crap!
But I'm just like, just give me the glasses. Yeah. I think it's fine.
I'm with
whatever,
you.
Whatever. I'll the nose piece. What? Like you know? Look at me.
Do you have a nose piece? Because a lot of them, the modern ones now, don't even have.
I don't even know.
He's got the ones.
You don't know what you got.
The switchable nose piece.
I don't know. I don't. Yeah. No. It doesn't have a nose.
Oakley Iridium.
So then you're fine.
It just looks like Daniel's.
Yeah.
Like that, but it's like
don't be copying my style,
Gray or something. I don't know.
We're both gonna look like.
I don't know the style.
From the Descendants.
So then I go. He's like, they're like, Mr. Van. And then I get up there, and so the glasses specialist, he picks these my glasses out the back. He's like, hey, and then he walks towards me. And then I'm standing there, and we both obviously got masks on. And
I hope he put the glasses on his nose and then put him on.
He does this
by
move
by kissing you.
I swear. Okay, he does this move. And he brings the glasses.
Like you're a baby waiting to be fed.
And then, but it's kind of.
Because he knew you were going to see for the first time.
But it's kind of far away. So I start leaning my head forward, like, do you want to put them on me? Is this the ceremony? Like, I didn't understand. And then he's like, no, you can. And then he's like, but he handed them to me. Right? Like this. And I was like, I started leaning forward. I'm like, do you want to.
Vision starts now.
I didn't know if it was. Like, I've never been involved, a part of any of this.
Special needs detective.
I love slapping you around. I love it, but I've never had that either. I've never had anybody do that.
I thought it was like the graduation sash. They put it in the lay. I was
That guy was just being extra nice.
I was like,
I've never had that.
Is this part of the ceremony? Like, do you want to put them on my face? And I thought that was super weird because then I started leaning forward. And then he was like, no. He's like, that's how I hand them to you. And I was like, that's weird. Like, why didn't you?
That is weird.
Hand them to me like this. Why put them open towards my face?
Legally, this is the way I have to hand them to you.
And then, I put them on, and then I'm like, all right, good to go. And then I go to leave. He's like, nope. I'm going to make it a couple adjustments. He takes them off. He walks into a room.
Smashes them with a hammer.
And then I didn't see what he does, and then walks back out, like, not even 1 second later. Like, he just walked into the room and turned around, and then he put them back on, because they have no nose piece or anything. And then he's like, perfect. Now it's perfect. And then I'm like, did you just walk into the room and turn around to make me think you did something?
I want him to put him on you and then be like, perfection.
Right.
Voila.
I was like, what could you have done? Like,
he could have tightened the screws on the side. Maybe it was leaning one
and
side.
And now they fully resist.
Tighten the screws?
Yeah, the little screws on the
side. Yeah,
he didn't have time to do nothing.
See, like mine. Like, they tighten mine and then they have this little tool where they can make the two arms, like, a little more even so they don't sit wapajon on my ears.
Anyway, I just didn't know the whole...
Oh, I can't wait to see these glasses.
So what color are these glasses?
They're like a gray clear.
Oh, yes.
Gray
you went
clear.
With the Guy Fieri? Yes! Yes, you got the flavor towns.
I'm never going to wear them.
Oh, the clear ones. Sally, Jesse, Raphael.
I'm telling you, I
can't. Oh, I love
it. Are they perfect circles?
They're round Roger Stones. You're putting
please,
two double pieces
on. Me the Roger Stones.
Oh, God, I love it. I'm so happy. Wear your clear glasses here so I can make fun of you.
These are too stony. I'm more. Yeah. McCartney.
Can you give me the saxophone player in Real Big Fish, please?
What?
I hope they're the ones that are like the future, where it's like no frame. It's literally just, they just sit on your nose, and it's just glass. I'm like, holy crap, the Matrix is here. He came from the future.
Yeah, it's anyway.
Did your wife clown on you at all, or does she like the fact that you're wearing glasses now?
No, well, no, I barely wear them. It's only,
which is the problem.
Yeah, but it's only a night. And the guy said, it's like, you just wear them when you want to. I find at home, by the end of the day, when I'm looking at my phone all day, I'm like, it just, I put them on, I'm like, my eyes are... like relaxed now instead of like straining.
And Tommy's
sounds like you need to wear them all the time then.
Yeah, I mean,
quit straining.
That is true. But Tommy probably likes the fact that Daddy's got glasses now too.
I
right?
thought that and didn't care.
didn't move the needle at all.
Not he wasn't like, nerd. Oh, you've got glasses. Because I put them on, I'm like, huh? He's just like, I want a color. I like, I want to play Nintendo Switch. I don't care about your old man glasses. Like, you don't care.
How much did you spend on these glasses that you don't have to wear if you don't want to?
Yeah. No, he only, just wear them whenever. They're leisure glasses.
I don't know. Like, it was supposed to be only $40 because my insurance, I have some sort
that's
of eye
insurance.
That's probably
just for the frames, not the lenses, right?
Well, or then they said the...
Never buy vision insurance. It's a crock.
The coating, I paid for the coating.
Oh, not the coating.
The coating.
You're not even going to wear them.
The coating was like $100.
Oh,
what?
God.
Yeah, yeah. And man. He said that you got to get the coating. It's scratch proof. He's like, for a guy like you, that
he doesn't even know you. What does he mean?
Like a guy like you, a real Florida cowboy. I got to put extra coating on this.
I think he meant white trash.
Yeah. But a guy like you,
I know your type.
You'll be dropping these a lot. You'll be dropping these on the floor of Walmart, the pet section, a lot.
He's like, I see. He's like, you must have won some sort of lottery or inheritance to be in here because it's a fancier. Like, it's in it looks like an Apple store.
There's glasses everywhere. Like, there's not models wearing them.
Yeah, it's not the old Walmart one.
I like that one. I like that. I like to get my glasses with the aroma of French fries in the air.
I like to get my glasses and then look right next door with my glasses. Someone get tested for AIDS.
Well, that's nice. I can read that gentleman has full blown. Can see it from here, 2020.
You put the Quest right next door to the glasses door door to the McDonald's.
You know, I wish I had seen that, actually. I'm just going to scoot over here a little bit.
I remember when I got my first blood test in a Walmart, and I was sitting there like in the waiting room looking at the Walmart, and I'm like, I probably should have gone somewhere else.
Yeah, well, you look out and you're like...
Yeah, because the waiting room seats look out into
the Walmart, and then you look over the top, and you see, and then way in the back, and you see Judge Joe Brown on a big TV. And you're like, that's weird.
Yeah. You know.
So you're not going to ever wear them here, so we're never going to get the luxury of seeing your glasses?
I just don't want to take...
The chat would appreciate it, so you could read what they're saying.
Or at least put a picture on the BDM page, so we can see them. So everybody here wears glasses except for Butler.
Butler wears glasses.
Yeah, but Butler's glasses are just those stupid...
they're fake.
Yeah, they're the ones his wife gave him to, like, make his eyes more snowflakey or something, right?
Yeah.
Like, it's supposed to protect him from computer lights?
Yeah, they're like blue blockers.
You got them on now.
You got to put the blockers on, right? Because that stuff, it's getting me right now. It's burning me.
You have to put protective shields from the blue rays.
Don't let those computer monitors get you. This one right here is literally burning my skin.
We are on ACT. Please don't curse.
He's going to curse.
All I'm saying is that I'm the only one here with perfect vision. All you guys have the messed up vision. I wear the blue blockers. I have the clean, the good vision.
Well, that could never be genetics.
It's all genetic.
Well, my parents both have glasses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, old people have glasses. They all
had glasses since they were younger.
You are on the brink because the guy told me, he's like, you're a little young for your vision, but he's like, at 40, everybody's vision starts
going. He made a bold statement. He said perfect vision.
Let's
put it to the test.
Let's
go.
I would question that it's 100% perfect.
Yeah, I would too, because there's a lot of stuff that we give you to do that doesn't get done. which would mean to me
so
that
you're either an R word or you're blind. That's the only excuse.
I'm leaning more towards R.
I'm sorry, I couldn't say that without laughing.
All right, but get out of here. Got no work to do.
Wait, I'll turn your mic back on.
Okay. Do you have the blue light thing turned off? Crystal turned that off on my phone a long time
ago.
All
it does is make your phone yellow.
Yeah.
I don't want a yellow phone.
That's it. She turned mine. I don't know how to turn it back, and I've got used to the slight yellow.
Yeah, this computer has it, too. I turn it all off. Yeah. I want bright blue white. Just drench me in it.
Because one time she turned it off, I was like, whoa, it looks so much blue.
And I'm like, I got to brush my phone. It's yellow corn. It's got corn teeth. I hate it. I look at it. It's fuzzy. I don't want a fuzzy phone. I want a bright. There's a reason that I have the 12. I had an upgrade, so I got the upgrade. This thing will burn like a blue.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
It's like the ocean.
Yeah.
Not affected.
I want to throw that off the Titanic. Yeah.
So blue. It is mega. That thing will literally one sweep of it, and you're blind for 3 days.
That's a good.
That's what I want.
Get that good deep blue.
I want it so white that, like, there's no eyes. There's just holes in my head.
Yeah. Stupid yellow phone. Turn this off.
And how is that better? I think it's a gimmick. They say, I better put the yellow on. Why?
Yeah. That's stupid.
No, but why?
Oh, because some doctor was like,
Fauci! It just felt right. I'm sorry.
Some doctor was like, this is a bad long term.
Yeah. But why? Yellow light? Worse for your eyeballs than bright white blue burning your eyeballs out white?
Some sort of sleep study shows that even if you, like, I know that Crystal, like, literally will take black tape and put it over, like, blue lights that are, like, on computers and printers and stuff because it keeps her awake, and she swears that the blue light, even the tiniest little tiny LED blue light, will affect her sleep.
That's crazy.
So I'm like, you're the guy from Better Call Saul, the brother, the crazy brother.
Oh, no, that's
that guy. And soon you'll be a full suit of tinfoil, scared of electricity.
Well, but then they'd stop using the blue lights, you would think, right? I'm seriously trying to analyze this because I have a remote control for my record player. You know, I don't have a super fancy record player, but it's very, very rudimentary. It only has one button on it, on button, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I needed to buy an amplifier for it. So I found this amplifier made in China, tiny little amplifier with a remote. It's like $20, but it has this ginormous bright blue LED blue light on it. Why would they even use that? If it's so disruptive and terrible for everybody and everybody hates it, wouldn't they stop using the blue light?
Well, the answer is probably it's inexpensive for whatever reason. Mm. Maybe the blue.
Well, the blue light on your little amplifier, you're not staring at it, but people are staring at their phones and their monitors, and that's the problem.
But what kind? I go back to like aspartame and like artificial sweeteners and like other things that everybody in society keeps telling us are like, this is bad for you, not good, the blue light or whatever. Like, but to what? How much? Is it, you know, because I'm... Because
eventually you get to, rock and roll, cola wars, I can't take it anymore! Right?
You know, I pour a lot, I mean, I can understand if you are...
Blue light, aspartame! It's like everything's bad for you.
Like, if you are healthy to the point where you are so regimented and strict with your diet and your exercise and everything, that the blue light is, like, the only bad thing you get, or the aspartame, you know, like, then I could, okay, well, take that stuff out. But if you... are like probably the majority of society, and you're like drinking a little too much.
Yeah, you're a big fat chungus, and you're worried about blue light.
Yeah, it's like, all right, well.
Look, all these cameras that we're using right now have blue lights on them.
It's like that blue light isn't going to help your heart and all the poison you're putting into your, like, middle of your body and your organs. Like, I'm putting so much poison.
Yeah, but the eyes are the windows to your soul, Tom.
Yeah. But I'm just saying, with the poison that I put in, I feel like the blue light's just a, you know, flying a horse at that point. It's a, you know, it's the horse has cancer.
No,
who cares about how many flies it has?
That's true.
Maybe the flies will eventually do damage, but
would the flies
the cancer get you before?
Because if I were a fly and I landed on a horse and I bit it, I'd be like, I taste some cancer in this. I think we find another horse.
And they must be irritated because they whip their tail around crazy. The horse flies are biting them. They're whipping their tail, and it's like, you got horse flies biting your ass at all times. My God! It's a miserable life.
Well, that's why you got the tail.
Yeah, but they still
it
hurts. Yeah, yeah.
Maybe it doesn't hurt them as bad because they got a big, thick hide.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But have you
When I get bit, I swear to God, I black out from a horse fly. I'm like, and I'm dead. Like, I black out dead in the pool. It's usually in a pool.
We don't talk about horse flies that often, but horse flies hurt like an MF.
Yeah, have you seen their teeth?
Yeah, yeah.
They're almost like bomb raids when you're a kid in the pool. Like, yeah, horse fly! And you would jump in the pool and hide.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, it would get me in the pool, and in the pool, it'd be like, it hurts so bad that I'm like, I'm going to drown.
Yeah. It's pretty
damn bad.
And
then it swells up.
Yeah, yeah.
Burns.
Yeah.
Look up horse fly. I want to know what the deal is, because I don't think it injects you with anything.
No, it bites. It literally,
it's just a bite, right?
Yeah, yeah. It bites you with its horse fly chompers.
Big, old, busy teeth.
How can a tiny horse fly bite my skin that hard?
Pound for pound.
It's ridiculous.
Okay, which insect has the biggest, I'm using air quotes, teeth? Does the horse fly, pound for pound, have the chompiest insect teeth?
No, I think there's a spider that can bite through a toenail.
What?
Yeah.
I love you, Butler. Some of the things he throws out.
A spider can bite through a toenail.
Yeah.
I like all of this.
Yeah. I'm confident in this one.
Yeah. I need to give you some of the blue light glasses. Those are awesome.
I am not confident that it's true. So horsefly, does it have teeth?
Everybody's saying bullet ant is the one.
Ant. That's the one where they put gloves on you and then you're hallucinating ayahuasca.
Oh, I've seen kids do that. There was a documentary about that.
Give him ayahuasca, put the bullet ant gloves on him. My God, that sounds terrifying.
What do you do the next morning when you come downstairs and you're like, French toast? You know, like you just wore bullet ant gloves and hallucinated to the moon.
So it says the flies mandible is what makes these bites so painful.
Big jaw. You got a
big
jaw.
The mandible is essentially the insect's jaw. It's shaped like scissors and can cut right into the skin. The mandible is also equipped with small hooks to help the horsefly lock in to feed better.
That makes me mad.
Once it's locked in, it eats the blood from the skin. This bite can cause a sharp burning sensation. It's common to experience itchiness, inflammation, and swelling around the bite area.
Oh, yeah. It saws your damn skin.
Dude, talk about a horror movie. Big horsefly. Yeah. Rick Moranis. He blows up the horsefly, and that thing just starts killing everybody.
That's where bug assault becomes big.
Yeah. These are just chomping.
Have you guys used your bug assault? I tried.
I had to. I melted one of my black stuff. I left it out there. I had the blue flame, jet black.
Did it scrape off?
In Baldwin, it looked like China. Like for one day because of all the soot that I was putting into. And the whole ceiling of my balcony, it just looked like I burned it out. So I had to clean all of that. And Andrea, not very happy. Yeah. And I had another one. I left it outside. It got wet and all the salt got chunky and then I smashed it into a million pieces drunk out of anger.
you gotta load them with rock salt. That's the problem.
What now?
You gotta load those things with rock salt.
I use the real salt that came with the bug assault.
See, I did that too and it just bounces off the bugs.
Yeah,
it doesn't do it. They just look at me all mad and they're just like, come, they fly at me.
Yeah, I tried to shoot my sons were they're shooting around for 2 seconds and then it was like I wanted it to be so good.
We gave it to our fishman, the guy that cleans our fish tank, is like a tip, and I'm starting to rethink.
That's why our fish keep dying.
Like, what the hell? Give me a toy, man. He's like, mad. He goes outside, throws it in a dumpster as he drives away.
All right, let's take a break. Do some voicemails. Bye bye. Welcome back to A Corporate Time with Tom and Dan. I'm Tom.
I am Dan. Samantha and Butler all hanging out today in the studio.
So we have someone on Skype, and I'm curious to what she's been doing since the pandemic started.
I feel like we haven't seen other human beings.
Well, we had her books.
Yeah,
I know. This was interesting. Yeah.
Our last event would have been, it would have been our last event, but we didn't get to execute it, right?
Yeah, because we literally called it days before when the NBA called it. We all were like, "Oh, like you know,
COVID's
like,
real."
Yeah, we're just like, "Well, the NBA, then Tom Hanks." It was like that week, and then we were like,
"The NBA and Tom Hanks are telling you something."
Yeah, well, yeah. Two of the biggest things in the world, right? Yeah. So, on the line with us right now is our friend Kat Ridgway. What's up, Kat?
What's up, guys? Thanks for having me.
Oh, no thanks problem. For doing it.
So, you were going to be performing at our BDM event back in March, and then we had to pull it last second because of COVID, and it was like at the time that it was first happening, everybody was confused on what's going on, and then obviously we all lived through it, the subsequent lockdown and everything, and now you're actually you're performing on Saturday at Elixir, free concert. Is it totally free to anybody who comes?
Yes, it is.
So, are you just telling people to just show up? You don't have to register or anything?
Yeah, you don't have to do anything. But we are, you know, being really COVID conscious and safe about everything. We're taking temperature checks at the door, strongly encouraging masks. We have hand sanitizing stations all around, all that kind of stuff. But as far as tickets go, it's all fair game. Just show up.
Awesome. Now, Kat, is this your first show since COVID started? Have you been performing other places?
I'm going to say, like, quote unquote, yes, but, you know, I've been doing a couple of, like, restaurant type gigs, just solo stuff that I do, like, more like cover shows. But as far as, like, me playing my own show with my band, this is the first time we're actually back on stage together. And it's, oh, man, I'm so excited.
Yeah, wow. Now, because there's been lots of talks about, like, how much this has affected entertainers out there, and especially entertainers that didn't have millions of dollars in the bank to just sit for a while and wait it out. I mean, we're talking about people that have to work every week and, like, you know, paycheck to paycheck entertainers. Not that you're that, but there's a lot of smaller bands and performers and stuff that make their living. It's just like, and now they are all out of work. Have you had a lot of friends? I'm sure you know a lot of other people in bands, entertainers that have had a rough go, and how'd you get through the past 8 months?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. I still ask myself how I've made it this far all the time. But I've been really, really fortunate to have my family just completely supporting me. So I've just been crashing with mom and dad. And I actually started a live stream series on my Facebook page where I was just learning covers that people were requesting, and I'd learn a whole slew of new songs every week, and we kept it up for like 10 weeks straight. And I was, again, just super, super fortunate, and I'm really grateful to everybody that tuned in, because they actually supported me and kept me afloat for months with the contributions and the virtual tip jar contributions and stuff that everyone was helping out with. And that's, I was awesome. Like, dang. And that was actually what allowed me to finish getting this record, the new record that's coming out this week. I was able to take all of those funds. That was what allowed me to be able to pay for everything. So thank you to everybody.
That's awesome. You know, we saw a lot of that happen. Like,
you
Jeff
really
Howell,
are, yeah.
And like some of our other friends that are entertainers and perform for a living, they started doing virtual stuff just to get by.
It's almost like direct-to-consumer music, you know, like...
And what's cool to see is the community support these people and their friends and family and fans of these people's art. They're like, we need to help them. I'll donate, you know, $10 each time they play virtually, whatever. And that's cool to see, like... No one ever talks about the positive parts of, like, hey, we were able to support each other in this and help each other out and help people that we knew were affected most.
It's easy to take that stuff for granted, but when we're all in the middle of a pandemic, which is something that, you know, I think for the most part, nobody even planned of thinking of the word pandemic, right? Of our lifetime, it's easy to take for granted these musicians and these great local artists that we have that provide for us in our communities, and now we kind of got a reminder of that. We're trying to prop them up.
So, Kat, were you able to actually learn a bunch of new songs because of it? Like, you know, we've talked to people that started doing something virtually, and actually they come out on the other side now, and they're like, "Well, I spent the last 8 months learning this, and
I wrote
actually
a book."
Or like, you know, they pivoted.
I learned a lot of new tunes, a lot of from a lot of artists that I hadn't even heard of before, just because people were like, hey, have you heard of this band? You should cover it, you know? And I was like, okay. So I learned a bunch of music when I was doing the live stream stuff, but I ended up switching gears. And with this new record, I actually picked up more graphic design skills.
Nice.
So the actual album cover and the album design and all of the merch and my website and actually down to the stage banners and all the promotional materials for this show this week with Sean Mullins, I did all of the graphic design for every single piece of, you know, merch or promotional.
That's
stuff.
Very cool, man. Yeah, that is very cool.
Well, it's cool that you took the time to learn something else. You're like, you know, it's a, you know, I like that. And it goes to show that
it's an arrow in the quiver, right? Like, it's a skill set that, you know, I've always looked at, you know, radio or broadcasting or podcasting is like that. Like, the more I can learn and the more arrows I can gather, then the more problems I'll be able to solve.
Exactly.
Kat, let me ask you a question. When did you realize, at what age did you realize that you were a musician or you had a talent for music? Because I'm trying to look at my sons and figure out where to push them towards.
Okay.
And it seems like my youngest, Max, he tends to go to, we have this big computer that my wife, or computer, piano that my wife uses as
step one, figure out the difference.
As a laundry folding station, and just sits there. And okay. Max is more gravitated to it. He'll push the, and I taught him Sonic, like ding, cool. ding, 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 ding. Mm-hmm. And, he's like, and that's all I got. And then Tommy's not interested in it. Is that any sign that, all right, Max is good to go with music?
Oh, yeah.
Or am I going to be totally off with that? Or, like, do you, what is it?
I don't know. For me, I remember my mom telling me, even when I was, like, a little baby, she would sing to me instead of reading me stories, and my eyes would just get huge, and I was just really responsive to music. So I think just the fact that one of your sons is just reacting to it and enthusiastic about it, that's enough to just keep putting instruments in front of them. Keep telling them, like,
the
make noise, be loud, you know?
See,
having the space to do that, that's the difference, I think, between people who end up going into having creative talents and people who maybe get kind of steered away from them, you know?
See, that's the thing, is he's not enthusiastic about it. Tom forces him to do it every afternoon.
Also, could you sing as a baby? Like, were you a singing baby? Like did they...
I called her Lady Gaga.
Hey, mama, where's your nipples? Like, I want some milk.
Will Max one day just start singing? I'm like, oh, he's a singing baby. He's got it. Or do I have to teach him? Like, will he do
it? I hope that one day you're just brushing your teeth, hungover, and then all of a sudden you hear, when you're down and out. And he's like singing like,
yeah. Like, how does it work?
That was great. That was exactly what I sounded like.
did you just say, were you singing as a child and everybody, like all the adults were like, whoa, this child can sing.
Or maybe they did that move.
Like, yeah. I just remember, like, I do have one very distinctive memory when I was still too young to be in school. So I maybe in preschool, and I was in the car with my mom to pick up my brother from like kindergarten or whatever. And the song, oh God, who was it? Ricky Martin with that song, like, you can run, but you can't escape my love. You remember that?
Yes, yes.
Forever ago.
You love that song, Tom.
That song is on, and I started singing along with the background vocals. And my mom was like, Catherine, you're on pitch. And I was like, what do you mean? And she's like, you're actually singing the right notes.
And I remember
her being like, I don't know, surprised, impressed, whatever you want to call it.
Sure.
And I was kind of confused that was the reaction. And then I just kept singing. And when I was little, I used to apparently sing the Titanic theme song all the time and like jump up on tables and stuff. I don't remember this at all.
I want to make a note. Make Max sing.
Yeah. What's his favorite song?
Living La Vida Loca.
Well, his favorite song is I Touch Myself by the Divinyls.
So you had a natural talent that your parents recognized young, like that you can, because that's, is it a thing where you have it or don't?
Like, I
kind of think so. Yeah.
You could now you could be close and maybe trained to get there, but the people that had like Whitney Houston just born,
yeah,
like or like you, yeah, Kat, you were just born with the ability to recognize the pitch and then hit it exactly. Yeah, all that's all natural talent, but then you have to work on that talent to make it better.
I think so.
So I'll be able to know as soon as my son sing, I'll be like, you stink. Don't go that way.
And it's, I think it's better, though, if your son's singing and he does stink. I do think it's better to be real with him than... I'm not saying you should stomp his dream out, but I am not a big fan of the parent who lies to the kid and builds him up, and then they are like 18 and think that they have the best. Right. You know what I mean?
Because
there's been no dose of reality. You know what I mean? Like, I'm being serious right now. Yeah, yeah. That you look, and I tell you guys all the time, I don't get uncomfortable on this show. That makes me uncomfortable when it's the person that you guys artificially pumped them up, and you did that because you thought that if you were real with them that you'd hurt their feelings. Oh, that hurts my heart.
Let's talk about instruments, Kat. Did you have a natural ability? Because I think it's with instruments too. Like me and Samantha were just talking before the show about.
Oh, that's right. You guys are in your recorder classes together, right?
Yeah.
About people that can play. They have no idea how to read music whatsoever, but they can play everything
by ear.
I know a lot of those people.
And like that's amazing to me. I'm like, what? You're just able to play what you heard?
Yeah.
How? So
yeah.
So were you like that? Did you have a natural ability?
I'm definitely more of a play it by ear type of person than sheet music for sure. But yeah, I think the first time I realized like, oh man, music is really cool. And my parents really got behind it was actually, you joked about recorders, but for real, when I was in third grade, you know, we had to do the whole karate belt recorder thing. And, I flew through all of the songs 'cause I was just so excited to learn all of them.
Yeah.
But the thing was, I was supposed to be reading the music, but I wasn't reading the music. I was just kind of, I would hear the song a couple of times, and then I'd just remember what it sounded like and use the notes to remember where to put my fingers.
That's exactly how I play, too. Yeah.
Yeah. And so I was like, oh, okay, cool. And then fast forward, and I ended up picking up the trumpet in fourth grade. And same exact thing there. Like, I can't sight read for crap, but I can hear something and figure it out pretty quickly.
You play trumpet, Tom. Yeah. Maybe you could get on stage with Kat.
Yeah.
Horn section, let's go.
Yeah, it's been a long time since you've, tooted on the old brass barracuda, as you call it.
Yeah. I have to tighten my embouchure.
Oh, yeah.
I get my lips... I got to get them tighter.
Yeah.
They got loose over time. Now
his lips are... You should have seen his lips yesterday. They were... Oh, man.
They're so loose.
He needed to have those things, like, trimmed up a little bit.
There's no muscle anymore. It's just so...
They've atrophied.
The elastic is worn out. Like,
even if he opens his mouth is still closed because his lips are loose.
Like, I can't even roll down the window when I'm driving, and if I'm talking on the phone, I roll down the window a little bit, my lips are flapping crazy.
We were at Publix yesterday, and they called us Turner and Hooch.
Oh my God!
I'm
That's
sorry,
Kat. Sorry.
No.
All right.
Well, we have to plug her gig again. Yeah. I just want to make sure we do our due diligence for Kat.
Free concert? Is it just you guys or the other band? I don't know.
She already mentioned
it's a big name. Okay, Kat, tell everybody who you're playing with.
Yeah, so I'm playing with my full band. It's going to be a 9-piece band with a horn section and everything. I'm super stoked. And I'm so, so, so excited. We're going to be sharing the stage with none other than Sean Mullins, who is the guy that wrote, "Everything's gonna be all right. Rock-a-bye."
See, she sings
so good.
Back
from the 90s.
Everything's
gonna be all right, Tom Vine.
And it's your CD release show, right?
Yeah.
It sure is, yes.
Can you get your CD there?
You can, and it's actually...
Why would she not sell the CD at a CD release show?
It is your CD release party. Can I get the CD there?
You can.
Are you running out of battery? what just happened?
What is going on?
I know you know the answer to that. Yeah. That's the dumbest thing you've ever said. Don't do the
to be bad.
I'm trying to promote it.
Are you?
I'm telling the people, you don't know how dumb our listeners are. They don't know. If they're listening to me, they're dumber than I am. So I have to tell them exactly what's going on.
He's not wrong.
You can't. No one's smarter than me is listening to me. Why the hell would they listen to an idiot?
Kat, this is going to surprise
nobody
you.
Nobody listens to a fool.
This is where I surprise you, Kat, and then I apologize to Tom. He's right.
Yeah.
So it's me and below. Only. Nothing above. Nothing.
Oh,
I'm sorry, Kat. Tomorrow, Elixir, because this will go out on Friday, so yeah, it's 8 tomorrow, 7:30 Saturday.
7:30 p.m., November 7th, Elixir. It's downtown Orlando on Washington Street. It's presented by the Jim Colbert
Show. And it's free. And presented by the Jim Colbert Show. It's free, and it's also a, it's like a, you know, like, hey, let's all be cool, bro.
Is old man Colbert going to be out there?
Too old to be.
He sure
yeah, he's got to be.
Immunity compromised.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. He can't survive. Oh no, man.
Don't take the helmet off. As soon as you take the helmet off.
Yeah, two masks on that guy. Mask on his hair.
Oh, my God.
Because you can't lose the rest, though.
Yeah, you know what I call him. Old Sleepy Jim Colbert.
Is Sleepy Jim going to be there?
Yeah, Sleepy Jim.
Oh, he's going to be mad.
You don't even know where he's at. He's fumbling. He's got his mask on his butt ass.
Oh, Sleepy Jim. Oh, he's sniffing your hair, Cat.
Don't let him sniff your hair, Cat. All right, Cat. Well, we love you. Have a great show. Thanks for calling in and letting us be a little stupid with you today.
Oh, my God. Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it, y'all.
See ya.
See ya, Cat.
She is too sweet.
Yeah. Oh,
because I don't think she realizes you guys have a relationship with Jim. You could tell she got uncomfortable when you guys were clowning him.
She should have. Sleepy Jim, we're coming for you.
I don't know why that's so funny. I still love that commercial at the end of the commercial where they're like, where he's like, oh, I love it.
Okay, I totally lost track of how much time we're supposed to do or whatnot. Do we
just let this roll?
Do we go? And look at the producer. Like,
I think we did 21 minutes with old Mike the Weather Page. So I think we have a few more minutes left.
What do you want to talk about here?
Lay my head on the table here for a second.
Lightheaded.
Has anybody ever done silence on radio?
They should.
I know it's unconventional.
We can do one moment of silence.
Remember when...
can we take a knee? Everybody else does it.
Oh, yeah. Here's a funny fact from old school radio days is that back in the day when they were simulcasts or we were with XM radio, there was this rule that you couldn't be silent for too long because it would trigger the software to think something's wrong, and it would kick it over to something.
Well, there was an inaudible tone that was buried in the programming. So what would happen is on certain levels, if it would detect the silence, it would send out that tone. You couldn't hear it, and then it would trigger the computers in New York City for our XM satellite radio channel. And we were on... I can't remember the channel we were on.
I don't remember either, yeah. It was back when they used to play a lot of radio.
Like 163, some channel like that. So
XM, you get free content.
So if you played a commercial, and let's say the after the commercial, you didn't have anything put in there, if it rolled for, and I believe it was 10 seconds,
absolutely,
which is a really long time, really, but if it rolled for 10, it would shoot that tone out, and then it would cue their commercial, so even though we'd come back, XM wouldn't hear us.
Yeah, they used to get so mad.
They'd yell at us and get so mad, and like sometimes I couldn't do anything about it, and there was this guy, he was like Harvey or something, he called me up from New York.
I mean, most of the time, we'd just be like effing off, and then we'd be like, oh, it's not on! And then we'd like hit play, and they're like, I wonder if it had 10 seconds, and then their phone would ring, and we're like, you kicked us off, or something.
Well,
sometimes like,
he'd call. I'd hear I'd see the hotline.
Like,
and I'd be like,
"Sir, I am poor. I don't know what's going on."
Well, so the hotline would ring, and I would realize in seeing the line flashing that we had let something happen. So I would manually cue it,
that way I had an excuse. Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, so I'd hit it, and then when I'd pick up the phone, I'd be like, oh, it played. Yeah, you know, right. Which is still the truth, but...
Daniel's good at, figuring out ways and excuses.
Well, Daniel's good at lying to protect his ass. Is that what you're saying?
It's a nice way of saying it.
Daniel is good
Daniel's
at lying.
Daniel's good at lying.
He'll lie and protect all of us.
that's a quality.
It's a quality.
Let's look at our strengths here. Samantha, ultimate paranoia. Daniel, you're the liar. Tom, me, also the liar. Butler, I got nothing. D-Rog, tell us how we're...
I'm about to go 3,000. I need 5 minutes. I'm about to go 3,000 on him.
I got nothing.
I got nothing.
Anyway, God. There's still, we still got more done.
No, I think we're good.
We're good? Okay.
You should be fine.
So, TomandDan.com for all things Tom and Dan. If you go to YouTube, subscribe, like and subscribe and share and put that alert deal on. Just search for Tom and Dan Live. You can watch all of our shows there. I've been putting up huge mega shows and video content's coming out a lot more quickly, because we have better machines now.
So, yeah.
Is there anything else we need to plug? Merch, TomandDan.com. There's always merch. We're going to have a buttload of new merch as we ease into your holiday season.
Tom and Dan hookups.
Hey, I'm putting up my Christmas tree this weekend. You're doing it too. Yeah. What about you, buddy?
I got to go after Thanksgiving.
But that only gives you a month.
Yeah. But I can't do before. It's a mental block for me. I don't want to start Christmas until after Thanksgiving.
I'm only doing it just because I need something fun. You know what I mean? That's the only reason. This is too early, but I know it's too early.
Right.
Yeah. No. Yeah, well, why not? If you're going to put it up there.
Spoke to the gentleman from Mosquito Nick's yesterday. Looks like I'm going to be getting some holiday lights.
Oh, those too.
Yeah, they're
pretty excited about that.
I didn't get Butler in there. I was going to be mad because they can only do three because of timing. Yeah. I was like, okay, well, me, Samantha, did.
Does he know? Homeowners, right?
Yeah. Oh, there's nothing to it. Like, he's renting. Don't decorate a rental house.
Doesn't he have enough lights? Can't he just set his Ghostbuster backpack in his driveway and just turn it on and put Christmas music on?
There should be a rule that you can't decorate a rental house.
Well, if you do, you just have to write rental in lights. I feel like.
Yeah, there should be.
Like the scarlet letter, like a big R.
A county, county mandate. Yeah. That it's like, all right, the beautiful lights are that one.
How come
rental.
You didn't decorate your eye rent? I'm sorry. I understand. Yeah.
Bye-bye.